There can be only one.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale, the podcast that should be sponsored by Netflix. Seriously, it's a win-win situation. I mean, we talk about movies, they have movies. Come on, Netflix, sponsor us for crying out loud.
Go ask them.
Oh, sure. Dear Netflix, I have a podcast called Cinema Royale. Would you like to sponsor us? Send.
You never know. Try it out. That could actually work.
Sure. Anyways, I'm the host, Mike Mixtron, and along with me are my esteemed film aficionados. This is a little different because we have five people in this podcast. You can see me on the bottom, and you see four people in front of me, and it's like totally weird looking at it. It's like, okay, instead of a cross, you have a square. It's like Hollywood Squares in here.
Then who's center square?
Nobody's center square. This is the only Hollywood Square. There's no center square at all.
Can I be Charles Nelson Reilly?
Sure.
I'll be Gilbert Gottfried. Whatever you say, you'll fall!
So let's...
Sylvie can be Whoopi Goldberg. And who are... And Jada, who do you want to be?
Tracy Triumph.
Tracy Morgan. Okay.
Anyways, let me start. It's gonna be weird introducing. Let's start from your point of view, guys. So from my right is Matt Brunet, also known as Animat.
Bob Barker reminding you, help control the pet populations. Have your pets spayed. Welcome to the one, the original Country Bear Jamber, and the Radio Dead Air audience. Go all around the world wide and around to search all for terrible stuff for a segment we like to call. What the fuck? We want the redhead! We want the red. And here's what's happening in your neck of the woods. Hey guys, welcome to the podcast. Sorry, I was in the wrong channel.
Thank you, Adrian Kronauer.
That was great.
Did I miss anything?
No, that was good. Wow. Right next to Matt, we have Sylvie, also known as Shame on Pretzel.
Also known as Sylvie of Nine, because I have to stick in that Borg reference, because I realized 2 weeks ago I totally missed that joke when I was talking about Alien 9. Someone said assimilated and ooh, over my head. So, happened.
Now we go to the top row. Top right for all of you guys watching this, it's James Sullivan, also known as Jaime-tude.
I'm not Jaime-tron or anything.
How about James 5?
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by an early morning wake-up call because someone just had to know whether or not I liked Five-O Goes West.
What?
What? It happened.
Think of Five-O Goes West.
Who the fridge now I want... would call you for Five-O Goes West?
Okay, yeah, what do you think of that? Seriously, we want to know.
Today's episode, we're going to talk about Five-O Goes West. James, what are your thoughts?
I enjoyed it. Now please don't wake me up like this again.
It's good. I love Tiger. Never do this again.
So let me introduce you to our new co-host. She's brand new. She likes films just as much as we do. It's Jada.
Hi.
I didn't come prepared with an introduction. I didn't like Ghost West at all.
Just say, I'm
really?
Jada. Do I need to say anything else?
For me, I thought it was okay, but it has its problems. I don't want to get too much into it because that's
not
our subject.
It's not the subject,
no,
Matt.
It's interesting. I learned something yesterday. I learned that Madeline Kahn was the first movie.
Who?
Madeline Kahn.
You know Madeline Kahn. Yes.
Not personally.
He needs to refresh his memory. He's looking it up on Google.
IMDb.
In IMDb, it says that she was in. How do you spell her last name?
Name a Mel Brooks movie. What's the first one that comes to your mind?
I'm now the podcaster with the second least amount of dignity here.
You're putting Matt to shame. Come on, Matt. You should know who she.
The moth in the bug's life. Oh, okay.
What?
She was? Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. She was the butterfly in a bug's life.
Also in the Muppet movie.
Briefly.
Okay. Yeah, I know Madeline Kahn. Yeah.
Took you long enough
to. You know her from a bug's life in the Muppet movie.
Yeah.
Okay, wait a minute.
That one.
So you haven't seen Blazing Saddles?
She the German woman?
Honestly, no.
Yes.
I'm just so tired of falling in love.
Young Frankenstein?
Not yet. Nah, I know. I've seen the producers, but other than that, like...
Well, she wasn't in the producers, so that's not going to help you.
You're just digging yourself a hole, Matt. You know that? You're just digging yourself a big, fat hole, Matt.
I'll go see it, guys. I'll go see it. Calm the fridge down.
Okay, so yes, it's Sci-Fi Month. We're actually in our second topic right now. We're going to talk about robots in films. It could be, you know, robots built out of machinery, you know, regular robots we see. It could be cyborgs, which is half human, half robots. And of course, possibly, if there's one out there, going to talk about robots with artificial intelligence. And yeah, so I'm trying to think of who should start first. And I think James has a interesting one featuring a certain robot character named Astro Boy.
Yes.
Why don't you tell me about him?
Well, I picked Astro Boy because it's an... I'm not just gonna pick on the movie that was made a couple of years ago. I'm particularly picking the sort of the franchise as a whole. I'd heard of Astro Boy up until, you know, a few years ago, and I never actually watched an episode or anything until I sort of got over this mini obsession that I had with another creation by Tezuka, the godfather of anime, and that was Kimba the White Lion. So Kimba was the gateway drug to me learning about Astro Boy, in a sense, and it did not disappoint. This is a manga series. It started out as a manga comic, and it went to television. They turned it into a TV cartoon three times that I can count of. Once in the 60s, once in the 80s, and once in the early 2000s. And it is the story of a boy who is reborn after having a horrible accident by his father, who's a robot scientist. And after the first episode, or the second episode or so, the father scientist gives up on the boy robot because it's not going to replace the son that he had. But that goes into a vantage point, and from there on out, Astro Boy is looked after by another scientist who's normally known in the English Astro Boy circles as Dr. Elephant.
I like that when you say vantage point, Mike's camera went into a vantage point of its own.
Mm-hmm. And
Dr. Elephant?
Elephant.
Oh, elephant. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. I heard elephant.
Yeah.
Fun. Isn't that a toy?
Yeah.
Sylvie's nodding.
He's kind of a hefty character anyway. I honestly don't know why they picked the name elephant. But in any case, the reason why I picked this show is that oftentimes there seems to be a common theme with certain robot related films and or franchises, and that is robots to be robots are sort of seen as or to be used as a surrogate for another kind of people. You know, they've got this to this point where robots are super intelligent. They're probably equally or more intelligent and just as capable as men are, or women, and
or women.
Men or women, and human beings, I should say. And it sort of creates a bit of a class divide between the two. You know, in the world of Astro Boy, robots are commonly actually treated as slaves. You know, they have certain functions that they are assigned to, and they are sometimes treated by their human masters rather poorly. But that's not entirely the central point of the series. The other half of that is picking out villains who have dangerous plans, and watching this kid who's been pimped out with all these different missiles and laser guns and everything to just go around, fly around, and kick ass. That's sort of the main appeal of the series, aside from the subtext. And so that's mainly what I enjoyed about it, and that's why I wanted to bring it up. Has anyone else seen the show, or?
I'll be very honest, I'm not really too familiar with Astro Boy. The most that I know is that it is one of the first ever animated series in Japan, and like it really got up. It's like, it's one of the first like popular characters that came out of an animated series in Japan, like that and Speed Racer. The most that I know, like, when you did mention Astro Boy, at first I was thinking you were about to mention the 2009 movie. Did you ever see that one?
I actually did, and I have to say that
thrilled?
I wasn't hating on it, nor was I too thrilled about it. What I saw from the trailer was something that looked like Astro Boy. It looked like the universe that I had been accustomed to, but instead, it also seemed like a westernized anime, and that's odd because it was produced in China.
Was it made by a Chinese? Wait, I'm just gonna check.
It was made by Imagi.
Imagi?
Imagi.
Yeah, it was made by Imagi.
Mm-hmm. They never really did anything else.
Yeah.
Hong Kong. Interesting.
That's because after the film failed, they sort of went belly up.
Yeah, that's what I kind of thought.
Yeah, I mean, like, the thing is that we are taught, like, I guess the Americanized version of that is that it's, I guess it mostly comes from the director, David Bowers. he was the director of films such as Flushed Away and two Diary of a Wimpy Kid films, and apparently a TV movie of Kirby Buckets. And he's in 2016, he will be the director of a Clifford the Big Red Dog movie.
Oh, that's right. They are rebooting Clifford. That's right.
So he's kind of an actor.
By Illumination Entertainment? They're doing it?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
What's the last book they adapted? The Lorax?
Yeah, that was.
Oh, boy.
We already had a conversation about that.
Yes.
When did we? Oh, wait, yes.
Dr. Seuss movies, we had that.
Yeah, we had that.
For these.
Yeah, yeah, it was the early seasons.
I have such things to say about Cat's Night, you guys. Such things. So many things.
Shucks.
Good things or bad things?
Should have thought of you way back when. My fault, sorry.
Less than positive things.
So,
positive things?
Less than positive.
Less than. Positive.
Less than.
Okay, good.
So.
I need to go surprised to say negative.
The only thing, as far as I can describe the 2009 Astro Boy film was, an issue that I had right off the bat was they completely discarded, what I was talking about with the whole robots being seen as another type of living being. There's a famous quote by Osamu Tezuka, where he's quoted as saying, "What I say in all of my work is pretty much the same: love life, love everything that has life, or something of that nature." And that's why, if you look through a lot of his different work, there's this sort of common thing of theme of different robots, different animals, different people coming together in the end, or something like that. This movie traded that out for a more typical environmental message. But it doesn't even. But even as far as an environmentally themed film, it doesn't even dive into that too much. And the second half of the film, hard to explain, but they turn it into Oliver Twist.
What?
Yes. Well, there's a portion where Astro Boy runs away from his father and ends up living with a group of kids in a scrap heap who are led by a character called Hammig, played by Nathan Lane. And the thing about this this scene in which they're introducing these kids and the guy that takes care of them, it's taken right out of Oliver Twist. You know, the
do
kids.
Do they sing about picking pockets?
They almost do. They almost do. Except actually, they sing. Actually, they if they did have anything to sing about, they'd sing about scrounging around in landfills. But and Nathan Lane as Hammig, who was actually a character in the anime, and as well as a character in Kimba the White Lion, confusing enough.
Wait, so are they in the same universe?
Yeah.
Huh.
Freaky.
You thought that Pixar invented the idea of having cameos in one film universe after another? No, that was Osamu Tezuka. He was doing that. So Hammig here is turned into Fagin, essentially. And Is it a very good film? I'm not going to say rush out and see it, because they miss out on about half of the things that made the TV show good. But I will say one thing that I thought was nice. Nicolas Cage as Dr. Tenma, Astro Boy, his father.
You have me at Nicolas Cage. I don't care who you play.
Tenma was a one-off character in the original anime series. He throws Astro Boy out in the first couple of episodes, and he's never seen again for the rest of the show. But in the 2003 show, they resurrect the character and they turn him into a full-on villain who wants to rise up and take over the world with an army of robots, citing up class warfare as his reason, or something of that degree. The Nicolas Cage Dr. Tenma is the only one that actually seems to come around and care again for Astro Boy in the end.
Yeah, because he seems like a father figure to he seems like a father figure for Astro Boy in that film, if I recall.
Yeah, if you recall the trailers. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so if you're stuck on Nicolas Cage, sure, why not go see it? I'm not stopping you.
Yeah, just if you're curious enough, just check it out. Just the one-time viewing. So, yeah, Astro Boy, I know of it, but haven't seen anything about it. So, and honestly, of all you guys have the most well-known, like, wide-release kind of, you know, movies. I, on the other hand, picked the weirdest, most underrated films ever. This is what I do on the podcast, so...
Yeah, like Strippers versus Zombies. Yeah, that's an underrated gem right there.
It's werewolves, by the way, buddy, but...
Well, either way, I mean...
I don't think they ever made Strippers versus Vampires yet, but... Anyways, and this has an interesting backstory of my film here. It's 1979. It's a film called Chomps. Chomps. This film is... That's how they spell chomps, and it stands for canine home, which is they take the H-O-M from home, I don't know why, protection system. It's a dog robot. It's got an interesting history because Joseph Barbera wrote the story, produced it, and wrote the screenplay for. This was supposed to be the first of many live-action films from the Hanna-Barbera company. But William Hanna was, and the other members of Hanna-Barbera were like, I don't want to go into live action. Joseph Barbera wanted to, you know, do this collaboration with American International Pictures. He has a friend there named Samuel Z. Arkoff. I think that's how I'm saying his name. And his original idea for this film was there was going to be a Doberman Pinscher that's a guard dog robot. But, of course, Arkoff's son, he was like, no, I don't want a Doberman Pinscher. I want a little dog like Benji to be the robot dog. And he's like, okay, let's do it. And just, it's a kid rated, I shouldn't say kid, it's a family oriented picture with a Benji type robot. There is a throwaway gig where they do mention the Doberman Pinscher as the prototype for the dog, but it ended up chasing cars and biting the tires off, but it's a really cute. If you knew the background, I was watching, it's like, oh, that's kind of funny, I mentioned it in the movie. So, but basically, this, think of it as a live action Hanna-Barbera cartoon, pretty much. You have, I was trying to make an analogy for this. Think of it like, take one part, the Jetsons, where there's the two feuding companies for the sprocket parts. That whole subplot of the show. Mm-hmm. It's basically what this is, and this in this movie, it's these two rival security companies who's selling security systems and all that stuff, and they try to one off each other. This inventor comes by and invents Chomps, this canine home protection system, a dog that it can protect the company or house or whatever. This dog is full of everything you think of, you know. Dog can, you know, see through walls and see outside for burglars, or, you know, have high-pitched hearing to hear stuff. He can run really fast, and he can, mind you, it's late 70s, so the vendor puts like a tape, like a little tape into the dog, and he has sound effects he can bark out. So you can hear, he'll bark out like an ambulance siren or a police siren or bullets, you know, or a big scary growl dog voice. And it's very threatening. It's a little small dog, but it's, there's a line in the film, it's like, one of the good, there's an evil and good side of the security branch. The good side, which is, the
evil security branch.
I'm trying to do good and evil because it's better to understand it. The good side, the inventor brings Chomps into, who he is dating the daughter of the guy who's bringing it to, played by Valerie Bertinelli. In her, one of her early roles, she plays, she's known for, you know, Hot in Cleveland. She's a bunch of other stuff in between. So they bring Chomps in, and the other company is like, you know what, this is perfect, let's steal it and have it for our own company. So it's like this kind of this scheme and plan, like, I gotta get Chomps, we gotta get Chomps, we gotta get this dog. And it's just, there's, alright, this film is rated PG. They try to bring it out to G, because there's only one reason. There's a dog, and it's the strangest part of the movie. There's a dog, you can hear its thoughts, like it's talking, like Garfield. And he swears. He says shit so many times. It's a dog named Monster. He's like a mean dog in the neighborhood. It's like, don't you go by Monster. Oh, whatever, lady. He's like commentating throughout the whole movie. He's just like, oh shit. Oh my god, where is he going? Oh, this ought to be good. It's just the weirdest thing. I just kept so laughing because I was like, really? That's the only talking dog in the film. Otherwise.
Well, you know, dogs like shit, they take shit, they eat shit, you know, it's a family picture.
Exactly. Like you do.
So. God, so funny.
You know, it's funny that you mentioned that it's made by. That one of the writers is apparently Joe Barbera, in an attempt to make a live action movies under the Hanna-Barbera name. But like, while you were talking, I was thinking, like, what if they do like that? I could see the idea of why they would go with it, because they could take something like Chomps and then they could make it an animated series.
They could, but
then there's a problem with it. There's a problem, like, you can't really turn Chomps into an animated series because that it already exists. Have you guys ever heard of Dinomutt?
Oh.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, Dinomutt's a robot dog.
Well, it's okay. It's okay. You know, Hanna-Barbera was recycling ideas all over
but
the place.
But see, and here's another thing I was thinking. Like, what if this film was a success? You know, this would have been a start of many, 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 many live-action films. And you could just think to yourself, what would they do? But end up flopping at the box office. The reviews are like, oh, Chomps ain't no Benji, that's for sure, because the damn dog looked like Benji. I was like, if they went to the original idea, they wouldn't be comparing to Benji so goddamn much.
Mm-hmm. You know, what you mentioned, it actually sounds familiar. It sounds a lot like when, like during the 90s, Don Bluth wanted to expand his company so much bigger. It's like, almost to be like the next Disney, to also make live action films, to have theme park rides based on his movies and stuff like that. So it's interesting to hear that it's like apparently Hanna-Barbera almost wanted to do the same.
Yeah, Joseph Barbera was just like so excited about it. It was like, we want to do live action films, and William Hanna was like, Good luck with that, buddy.
But that's the thing with chomps. It's like, you know, when I realized that this is based on Dino Mutt, why not actually make, like, a Dino Mutt movie?
Yeah, I know.
Why go out and completely create an original thing that not a lot of people would know and they would associate way too easily to Benji to something that already exists? Like,
can you guys excuse me for just 1 minute?
Okay. Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Because this is kind of how they operate. You know, they float from, they were floating from one idea to another, trying to find something that was successful, and they didn't exactly mind whether or not the new idea that they were going for was trying to recapture the success of a previous venture, or just trying to recreate it. I mean, look at some of their creations, Pixie and Dixie and Mr. Jinx, or Motor Mouse and Auto Cat. Those were them trying to recreate the success of what else? Tom and Jerry.
Tom and Jerry, yeah, that's true.
And
because they don't have the rights anymore.
Well, they didn't have the rights at that point.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, they did get them back.
Yeah, they eventually got them back in the mid-70s with the new Tom and Jerry show. But
sorry about that, guys. Just a heads up. I might have to end up, like, moving this computer or something a little later.
It's okay.
That's fine.
Yeah, James does that sometimes.
It's normal. It's normal. We do that all the time. We move around during stuff. Mm-hmm. Time in.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. I guess this Chomps just sort of sounds like, okay, they had a success with Dino Mutt Dog Wonder, mediocrely anyway. The show's kind of
yeah, honestly, the most that I remember is that crossover episode with in Dexter's Lab. That's
yes.
It.
Oh yeah.
The Blue Falcon must have a real sidekick.
Oh man, yeah. Yeah, and it's also on Netflix, so if you have a Netflix subscription somehow, it's on Instant, you can actually watch it for yourself. If you're interested in watching a film about a robot dog and another dog named Monster honestly swears like a sailor who says shit all the time, which is the weirdest fucking thing I've ever seen. It's a really cheesy movie. It's a really cheesy, cartoony kind of movie. If you're into those movies, Chomps would be the movie for you. Yeah, really. It's like really cheesy because, the sound effects. Like I said, they have a tape. He has a tape for, you know, sound effects and. You know, Chomps uses it whenever he can. You know, he uses, like, the major big growl, you know, to scare away the dogs or scare away the robbers. He'll use the bullets to scare the robbers, or he'd be like... It's just...
Like, just sound effects or actual bullets?
You know, it's actual sound effects. They make it sound like a...
Oh, sound effects, okay.
It's sound effects. You just hear, like, it's like... It's like they mute the dog barking and just put the sound effect over the top, so you just hear... You see them barking like... It's just so funny. And then you go, and you hear the siren go, and people are like, is that a cop coming? Because there's actually, there's a chase scene, and there's a bunch of cops sitting out eating donuts. Of course, cliche. And he's like, oh, look at that car.
Well, if I know dogs, they can't keep their mouths open for that long. So it's just going to look like it's like,
yeah,
you know, it's just gonna look weird.
It is. That's what it is in the film. He keeps moving his mouth and it's coming out of his mouth. It's so. Yeah, it's actually really. I loved it. So.
Dogs eating donuts. You haven't seen that in any cartoon.
What? Dogs eating donuts?
Cops.
That's
oh, really?
All the time, man.
It's the most cliche thing. You need to wax your ears. You clean that weird accent. Okay.
Yeah, what
you said.
Yeah, I couldn't understand a single thing you were saying. Maybe you're right.
Yeah, use that hair of yours to, you know, wax
Anyways, let's hop from 1979 to 1985 to a film where which I had to look up to see if it was actually a robot or not, but oddly enough, Sylvie wants to talk about weird science.
We had to actually go on IMDb to see if the keywords corresponding to the movie considered one of the main characters of Weird Science an actual robot, and I guess kind of technically it is.
She was a robot. She was made out of technology.
It was weird.
Yeah, so it's just...
yeah, she's basically made from technology, which kind of...
And this is why
I'm kind of brought this up, kind of like it's kind of like a controversial thing. Like, is she really a robot? Is Lisa really a robot? It's just because it was listed under the female robot and cyborgs list on Wikipedia. Of course, you can trust Wikipedia.
Like, she's not a cyborg. She didn't start out human.
No. She has to be a robot. It's because.
Yeah, she actually started out, so Weird Science, it's about these two geeks, these two socially inept geeks, Wyatt and Gary, and they want to create the perfect woman. And basically it gets into that storyline in like the first 10, 15 minutes. There's no real build-up. it's a real kind of bizarre movie. So they do make the perfect woman. They make her with, technology, the most advanced computer of the time, 1985.
Floppy disks and everything.
Yep, the whole nine yards. And they plug it up to a Barbie doll. And, a bunch of weird things happen. And then suddenly, through the door comes this amazing, beautiful... perfect woman, who they dub Lisa after Gary's crush. So it's basically just hijinks after that. It's Lisa taking these two geeky boys, trying to make them men, trying to get them popular, trying to get them to score with other chicks. And the main thing I think of when I see this movie is like Weird Science. That's probably the most apt or appropriate name for this movie, because you watch this film and you see how they go from having like plastic and making this woman, and you're like, science does not work that way. Science doesn't spontaneously turn walls blue or flip ceilings upside down or make people catatonic. So it's a really, really bizarre film. It was actually my first time seeing it. I had never seen Weird Science before.
That's cool.
That's why it was kind of a shock for me. I don't know. It's not the first John Hughes film I've seen, but it's definitely one of the weirdest films. Like, I've seen Home Alone and I've seen Ferris Bueller and Pretty in Pink. So I'm watching this and I'm like, okay, this is way out of left field. But it's a.
This is what happens when the 80s gets high and drunk at the same time.
Yes. The best
it's
one.
It's a fantastic film. There's some nitpicky things, like the two main guys, the guy that plays Gary, he's okay, but the other guy that plays Wyatt, like the rich kid with the computer, he can't really act. Like the acting's really wooden in a lot of spots in this film. So I don't know if that plays into like the 80s camp, but it just throws like common sense and any sort of logic out of the window. It's a movie that just doesn't give a fuck, but that's what makes it awesome, and that's why I definitely recommend that movie.
Gary, you mean the Anthony Michael Hall character?
Yeah, Gary. Yeah, Michael Anthony Hall. He's normally good in any other John Hughes film, but I guess, I don't know.
Well, I mean, it was 1985.
Breakfast Club and 16 Candles, basically other John Hughes movies.
Maybe he was just out of his element.
Well, it's his third John Hughes film. He was in 16 Candles, Breakfast Club, and then Weird Science, so I don't know what his acting got out of whack or something. I don't know.
They let him ad-lib or improv, and they probably shouldn't have let him do that. There's a scene where they go to this dive bar, and I guess he gets drunk or stoned or something, and then, like, basically for the next 20 minutes, he's talking in this weird sort of, like, old man accent, like a jive talking, and I'm like, why? Why is that necessary? And I thought, is he going to do the whole movie like this? So, yeah, it's, don't let him go off the script, because it's awkward.
So how's Robert Downey Jr. in the film?
I wanted to say that I've only seen bits and pieces of this film. Sorry to cut you off, Sylvie.
Yep,
I've only seen bits and pieces, but I know the scene you're talking about, and I saw it on television, and I don't need to have seen the original source material to sort of guess what was said. I mean, it was so dubbed.
You're right, because it's a TV broadcast of it. Of course it's going to be dubbed, because, you know, yeah. Yeah.
Just saying.
Yeah, Robert...
But Robert Downey Jr., called Robert Downey in this film, he didn't warrant the junior yet, so he plays, you know, typical meathead douchey jock. He's awesome in it. Like, I can't... But he's not the douchiest character, surprisingly. Like, there's him and there's one other character that harass Gary and Wyatt.
Yep.
But actually the douchiest character is Wyatt's brother, Chad, played by Bill Paxton.
Yep, Bill Paxton, yep.
Oh, he just amps this movie up. Like, oh my God. He's such a like, an asshole. But it's awesome. Like, I think there's one point where they come back from... Gary and Wyatt leave the dive bar, and Chet ambushes them in the hallway, and he's basically teasing them about knowing this alleged character Lisa, and then, like, suddenly out of nowhere, he starts, like, I don't know, like, convulsing, almost like he's gonna puke, and then he just, like, laughs and then walks off, and it's, like, totally random, but it's just, like, the character is nuts. I personally think he's one of the best acted characters in the movie. Take that what you will, because the main three are questionable at best. But at least for Lisa's case, she's the TNA, she's the eye candy. So I guess she doesn't necessarily have to act, if that comes with the territory.
And she's a robot, you know, so she can sound emotionless.
Yeah, yeah, robot. She's
like,
she can.
Oh, she's a robot.
Yeah.
I would have loved to hear my feminist college professor's opinion on this film.
That would be.
Oh dear.
Oh boy. But no, the strangest.
All men want to create the perfect woman, and this movie is the.
Especially nowadays, this is hot water territory now, James.
Yeah, I just.
Do you really want to enter on that field?
I just wanted to mention that this film is based on a comic.
Oh yeah, I forgot.
It's weird because I was like, wait a minute, this is actually based on a comic called Weird Science? It's a comic book movie. You don't think about it until now.
That was also a TV show after that.
Yes, it's so popular it became a TV show, and I was like, how do you expand this movie into a film? Into a show? I messed myself up. How do you...
I heard that they basically explained how in the first episode, when one of the kids, they said... says, oh, but it's possible to create a woman. I saw it in a John Hughes movie once.
Yeah, they do. Yeah. God.
So far.
Cue the laugh track.
So it follows different characters. Just with similar premise.
No, it was the same characters, just different actors.
Okay, so it was the same characters who saw a movie about their own characters?
Yeah, it's...
What?
Yeah. It's...
Really?
Don't make me talk about the Ferris Bueller show. In the first episode.
Yes.
In the first episode of the Ferris Bueller show, the character Ferris Bueller lives in California instead of Illinois, and he says that the movie was based on his life, and he takes out a cardboard cutout of Matthew Broderick and sliced it in half with a chainsaw.
Oh.
In the pilot. And I'm like,
okay. If you're going to start out by defacing Matthew Broderick, you're going to, like, have some semblance of respect for me.
It's just...
No, if you start out by defacing Matthew Broderick, you better be damn good after that.
Exactly. Yeah. Mr. Oh, I'm Ferris Bueller. I don't
trust
know.
Trust me. Honestly, like, trust me. After watching it, you would want Matthew Broderick back.
Mm-hmm.
Because
that's
he...
But isn't Matthew Broderick, like, a cardboard cutout in... usually anyways, so... That's, like, probably his best role in that show.
Nice.
Yes, he's a cardboard cutout who married a pinup mom.
Didn't he marry a
life's
horse?
Not fair.
All right, now we're getting to.
It took you guys a moment to get that.
Oh my god! Okay.
It's official. Matthew Broderick's a brony.
Oh god! Okay. Yeah. Let's talk about something interesting besides whether or not Lisa's a robot. Let's talk about something that's different than a robot. Let's talk about cyborgs for a second. RoboCop.
Are we gonna do mine now?
Yeah.
If we're gonna do mine, then I should probably move my computer now, so I don't get interrupted. Would it be okay if you guys talked about weird science for like another minute?
Or we can go to my film if you want.
Okay, but when I come back, I'm gonna need some catching up. Sure. I don't want to have while I'm moving the computer because I don't want you guys to see my whole messy house.
I could fill in with something unrelated to weird science, but it kind of plays into the robot theme.
Sure.
I don't know which way to go with this. And maybe I'll talk about the one Chappie. When we were talking about Chappie earlier, the trailer, you mentioned that Hugh Jackman was in the film. There's actually two other people. They're not necessarily actors, but they are prominent South African icons.
Yes, I remember. Yeah.
Oh, those. About. Oh my God.
Yeah. Oh. Ninja and Yolandi.
Oh my God.
Were they like death rappers or something?
They're musicians.
I know they're musicians.
I've seen one of their music videos and. Oh my God.
Which one was it? Baby on Fire. You got to see that one.
I think I've seen that one. Oh my god!
I love it. I put it in the bottom if you guys want to see it. But it's
is that what you put up?
That's what I put. I wanted to see because like that's what really stuck out to me in the trailer. It's like, oh my god, it's the dudes from the Antwoord or however heck you call it.
It's gotta be there. It must be their acting debut or something. If they rap like that, I couldn't imagine how they would act in a film.
Well, I heard.
Well, you never know. I hear 50 Cent's a pretty good actor.
That's
the last movie he's.
Name.
Well, he wasn't. I think he was in SWAT, but I remember like.
Well, I'm just saying there's a lot of musicians who can't act. I mean, Hugh Jackman, I wanted to bring up actually. It was kind of weird how he's in another robot film called Chappie. He was also in a robot film called Real Steel, with fighting boxing robots, and it was weird because Real Steel came out. How was it?
2012.
A couple of years ago, or was it? I think it was a couple of years ago. The same year, I believe, Sci-Fi did a series called. What the fuck was it? Sci-Fi did like a reality series where it was boxing robots. They actually built robots for each team.
I know exactly what you're talking about. Yes.
Yes, that. Because I know I was talking to somebody about it back then when it came out, but it was. I can't remember what it was called. It was Super League. Robot Fighting League or something. And it had Chris Jericho hosting, and it was just basically. They were paired off in twos, a couple of teams. Even George Lucas's daughter was in the roster. Mm-hmm. As one of the people boxing, and they built these giant robots, and each one of them had like a special ability or characteristics about them, you know, advantage over the other robot, you know, special kind of weapons, and one person would operate the robot, I believe, and the other one would kind of Was there two people controlling, or was it only one person controlling?
Yeah, there were two people controlling, like...
Oh, yeah, one... There
was one who was moving the robots, and the other was, I don't know, doing the computer stuff.
That was strange, and it was kind of interesting seeing how that went on in real life compared to Real Steel, which was pretty much just...
I don't know. Bad.
That, because I was thinking it was a CGI or it was a real robots. I don't think it was.
Because I remember seeing that episode, like... I just put it on just to give it, like, noise or just put a random thing on TV. And I remember when she was there and she was like, yeah, and also I needed help from my dad. By the way, he's George Lucas. It's like, what are you talking about? And then, there he was.
Yep,
George Lucas.
He
like,
came.
What is this?
Yeah, he came to see his daughter do stuff. And I was like, what the fuck is this? And she's like a MAA fighter or something. It's weird. It's like, really, you're the daughter of George Lucas and you're a female fighter? Totally opposite worlds.
Yeah, your robot looks great, dear. I'm sure you can do fine with this.
Exactly.
Don't pack a punch. I'm gonna go off and make more money now with Star Wars. Oh, hold on a sec. Can you hold on a minute? I think Disney is calling me for something. Yeah? I don't care. I don't care. You know, it's your problem now. I'm free from Star Wars. That ball and chains is over, bitch.
What? What? Can't hear you.
What?
Speak up.
What?
You know.
Oh.
Speak up.
Microphone. Microphone's not there.
Back. Okay.
God, fuck.
Microphone's not connected.
We can't hear you.
Go under tools. Go to options, audio, settings, and make sure that the proper microphone is.
Oh. Yay!
Just trying to help.
God, walk!
Welcome right. back.
Yeah,
very mustard color.
I think you need a light meter.
I don't know that.
We're just getting luminescent, fluorescent, energy-saving, swirly light bulbs.
Yeah, we're talking about lighting. That's how awkward we are.
Operated by machines. They are robots. It counts.
What do you think about this lighting?
I don't think my light bulbs need any artificial intelligence or anything.
So robots, you know, they're machine built, but the unique thing is about cyborgs, which are half human, half robot, and there are some good cyborg films, there's some bad cyborg films. I mean, especially if you want to talk about the cyborg franchise with Jean-Claude Van Damme and Dolph Lundgren. Ugh. It's very confusing.
Good to know.
Don't even dab in that. But another good franchise we kind of mentioned briefly before was the RoboCop.
RoboCop, yes. That's what I'm here to talk about. The first movie, anyway.
Damn it, woman, I need RoboCop.
It's an inside joke.
Okay, here's what I've seen from RoboCop. I've seen the original movie, which I loved, and I've seen the remake, which I
didn't love.
I haven't seen the sequels. I haven't heard anything that's encouraging me to see the sequels.
Don't. It gets worse. It gets...
And then there's...
Go on.
Yep, go on.
I like a lot of things about RoboCop. I like, I guess the premise is not something that I found entirely original, but I thought it was really well done. I liked how they dealt with the making the character sympathetic while also making him act a lot like a robot. You know? Alright, hi again. Another buddy cameo. I liked how they portrayed the world of Detroit. You know, my dad, who introduced me to RoboCop, told me that it was kind of funny how they pretty much predicted exactly what Detroit would end up being like. Like, before. Detroit's like that now. Minus the RoboCops and the Kurtwood Smiths. Yeah.
And the Omnicorps. Well.
Omnicorps, yes. And incidentally, even if you don't count cyborgs as robots, you can call this a robot movie because of the cyborgs, cops, things, the robots. It counts.
Yeah, it does. You could talk about, what was it? His name was Ed. Stop motion robot.
Go motion.
Go motion?
Go motion.
Oh, was it go motion? Okay. It looked very stop motion-ish to me. I didn't even know what.
Yeah, the effects were not very good.
Well, it was.
It was the 80s.
It was the 80s, yeah. And it kind of had that.
It was the end of the stop motion, like, special effects era. You know, like, even.
Most of it, at least, yeah. Yeah, it was like the mid 80s, late 80s that it kind of slowed down. I mean, there was a couple of films that started in the late 80s, early 90s with stop motion. But, anyways.
Not the best stop motion effects. Really good gore effects.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Especially in, like, the director's cut where you see, like, the one guy get, like, shot full of bullets.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Whoa, okay. And, I like the female cop, although I didn't like her as much as I think other people did, because her character was, like, hyped up for me a lot, because everybody was like, how this character was so cool, and how dare they replace her with a dude in the remake, which I agree. How dare they?
Yeah.
No, I mean, she didn't do much, did she? Like she sort of talked to RoboCop, sort of told him.
Yeah, she was there for Alex Murphy, pretty much.
Yeah, like, action-wise, she got knocked to the sidelines a lot.
Yeah.
Which is disappointing, since she is kind of an action-y character. She's like a female cop, and I liked that when she showed up as a female cop, and she was like, hey, I'm your partner, there wasn't, like, a big deal made about, oh my god, you're a girl, and you're a cop, and I can't work with you, you're a girl. There was none of that. It was just sort of like, hey, nice to meet you, fellow cop, who happens to be a girl. I like that, but character-wise, she wasn't the best. And I'm told that she dies pretty anticlimactically at the beginning of the sequels anyway, so.
Actually, it was the third film.
Third film?
They do something kind of strange. At some point, RoboCop gets jostled around after her death by the hand of the bad guy that movie, and what his brain connects together is that the female cop is actually his wife, and they just killed her off.
What?
What?
Wait,
yes.
He saw his wife. In flashback form, she was a completely different lady.
Exactly.
You know what? I kind of hope they do that with the remake. I kind of hope it turns out that the black guy was somehow his wife the whole time. And the actual wife character was like a hologram or something. I don't know. It would be so stupid. It would.
There needs to be a wedding scene. Isn't the black guy Samuel Jackson?
No, Samuel L. Jackson, he shows up in, like, some commercials or something.
Yeah, it was.
He's a
that would have made things so much better. Just have a wedding scene, and then, like, I was like, do you take RoboCop to be your wedded husband? I do, motherfucker! You just see him in a wedding dress.
Damn it, woman, I need RoboCop! You tell me where his suit is, woman?
No, RoboCop is late for his wedding, and then you just see the bride, damn it, preacher, I need RoboCop!
If you're not getting why those two are laughing, it's a throwaway line in the animated series of RoboCop in the pilot episode. Mm-hmm. We watched it for an episode on the podcast, so.
Damn, does everything have a freaking series?
Yeah, so RoboCop was big enough to have two, or was it a couple of TV series? It was
just one series. It was Bill and Ted that had two series, I think.
RoboCop was a live-action series for one.
But, like, don't even get us started with the Killdozer.
I know.
I guess I could talk about the remake, too.
Okay.
The remake wasn't as good. It didn't have a Kurtwood Smith character, which was a shame, because Kurtwood Smith was like the best part of RoboCop.
Oh yeah, yeah, guaranteed.
Right?
Oh yeah.
He's the mobster guy. He's also the dad in that 70s show.
Who doesn't know him? He's one of the
he's
best.
That character, he was fun. He was like psychotic and snarky. But there's none of that in the remake. I think there is a mobster character.
Yeah, they
but
just...
he like dies like halfway through, and then it's mostly focused on Michael Keaton.
Yeah, but don't they try to make it way too serious, you know?
Yeah, it's probably like,
try to dark knight.
It's like a gritty RoboCop kind of thing.
Yeah, but it didn't work. Cause like, and it could have worked because it's a dark premise, but somehow it didn't work.
You know, I want to mention actually something about RoboCop is that I remember seeing this one thing. It was actually this very recent, I think 2013 or something, where someone tried to do like a reboot of, not like an official reboot, but it's like a fan-made reboot of RoboCop, which would be exactly like the 80s movie. Wow, it's like one of the most messed up things that I've seen. It's pretty much RoboCop trying to save this girl from a bunch of thugs, and they were about to rape her. What ends up happening is that, oh god, it's RoboCop pretty much shooting this guy's dick. It's like this guy, like he turned around, we see his dick, and then suddenly it exploded. What happened afterwards, another group of guys came in, like, trying to do the same thing. Harassing a girl, like, got their dick out, and then RoboCop shoots their dick out. Afterwards, what? 50 guys come out, all with their dicks out, and RoboCop shoots every single dick, and we see all the practical effects of exploding dicks. It is the most weirdest and messed up thing I've
ever
seen.
Are you sure that these guys were actually coming there for the girl, or were they coming for getting their dick shot up? Because that's the only explanation I can think of.
I have no idea.
Like shooting everybody's dick. Let's go!
Because there's literally a horde of guys that came in all with their dicks out, and it's like, what the hell?
Was it all for the damn?
I don't know. It's like, it really does it was really well made. The RoboCop's, like, the guy who portrayed RoboCop, it's like a really well-made costume, and, like, it really is RoboCop, it really does feel like RoboCop. And, like, even the practical effects on the exploding dicks, I mean, like, it brings back old memories of good practical effects, but it's still
old
the idea of, it's still exploding dicks.
God, it's just like prom night. What?
Oh, this is, yeah. This is the last time I get the clap.
So
I just have to mention that.
You just had to mention that. God.
It is RoboCop related. You can go check it out.
It is RoboCop related.
It is RoboCop. It actually is RoboCop.
God. Let me see if I can find a mashup that I saw once called RoboCop versus Terminator.
Oh,
I actually have an SNES game of that.
That's a game, and it's based on wasn't it based on like a comic or something? Yeah, it was based on a comic. Yeah, yeah.
Well, they actually.
Oh, they actually made a video. Somebody made a video with them.
They mashed up
the two films.
Clips of the two films.
Yeah, I think I've seen that too before.
Seamlessly.
That was pretty cool. Yeah, it's pretty creative. Yeah. And RoboCop is one of those films that is very iconic in people's eyes. I mean, when people heard about the remake, they were like, no, 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 you don't know, do not remake RoboCop. That's just something that's untouchable, according to some people.
Well, I mean, luckily with all remakes, they just, like, just tossed it away, not caring about it, and just go back, like, being happy with the original.
Yeah, they should just. I mean, there's some films you can't really redo, I guess. Like, RoboCop is one of them. It's like, it stays in the 80s. It doesn't resurge back. I mean, of course, that was a franchise, and they was like, oh, let's reboot the franchise. It'd be cool with the cool kids.
Well, I didn't.
Like, social commentary as a story, and that's hard to, like, copy into a different decade with different problems unless you change things up a lot, and they made no attempt to do that.
I thought they changed up a few things, but it doesn't necessarily, in my mind, replace the original. With the RoboCop remake, you have a character who's, for a certain of certain scenes, I actually think he's a better actor, because, you know, this is a guy who actually had a lot of tear-jerking moments. You know, he's reborn as a robot, and he's actually freaking out about it in some parts. He's not entirely robotic or emotionless, so that's one thing that's different. The other thing that's different was the original RoboCop was separated from his family after the death, you know, completely removed and everything. Harry is trying to readjust with his family after he's been rebuilt, and so on those levels, I thought that they made the right choice to try and do something different, at the very least. But do I think that the remake is a great film and I would replace the original with it? Probably not. I mean, they just had a formula with the first one that worked, so long as you plant your brain in the 80s, and with the new one, they got something that works, so long as you plant your brain in the 2010s.
Yeah.
It's two different kinds of works.
Yeah, it's two
one
different.
One works better than the other.
Yep.
Depending on who you talk to.
Yeah.
RoboCop 3, on the other hand, that was pretty bad.
Most sequels are not that good, depending on which franchise it is.
Sequels have a better track record than remakes do, though. Let's be honest here.
True.
Not that RoboCop is, like, the worst remake I've ever seen. I've seen some pretty bad remakes.
Yeah, we'll eventually have an episode all about remakes. So let's flash way into the future, into 2008, I believe. Isn't that what?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just making sure I'm gonna get my years right, because WALL-E. What is with WALL-E, Matt?
Well, WALL-E. I mean, it kind of is a little bit simple to explain. WALL-E is just a love story between two robots, but it's actually done in a way that you wouldn't really expect nowadays. Because here's the thing, WALL-E is actually, for the most part, a silent film. There's we don't really know the actors playing WALL-E and Eve. We don't really know who they are much. But, like, they're not big-name Hollywood stars. They don't even talk much. Like, their emotions and how they, like, their emotions, their, and everything, how they feel, their sentimental issues and stuff like that, they're mostly shown through their body, their movements, their expressions, and all that stuff. And it really makes something that's actually pretty interesting. And, you know, and mostly, you know, and it really is interesting how they put in, like, this backstory even to the robots. Like, WALL-E was supposed to be, like, this, supposed to be made as a garbage, pretty much someone to sort out garbage. And apparently that's all he's been doing all his life. And pretty much, like, he's pretty much bored, and even down to the point where his only friend is just this little cockroach. So that's why, like, this love story kind of blooms out when Eve would come in, and, like, things would go from there. It's pretty much WALL-E trying to experience, like, these new emotions. And it's mostly coming from this old movie that he saw. I don't recall which one it is, but it's, like, this
Hello
music.
Hello Dolly, I think.
Yeah, Hello Dolly.
Hello Dolly.
Yeah, from what he has seen from Hello Dolly, and he wants to experience that. And it really is, it creates something that is very touching and also very beautifully animated. Like, even in terms of, like it's very detailed, it's very defined in every single aspect, from, like, how WALL-E was built. And even one thing I want to mention is actually the cinematography. Because they try to have a more, like, you may not notice this, but in WALL-E they try to have a more realistic camera, per se. So you're going to see a lot of things
that you might not notice immediately, but like it would normally only be done in like live action. Like there's even an instance where like the camera would blur and like refocus in one scene. And also another thing I want to mention, but like if we are going to talk about Wall-E, there is one thing that we can't really avoid, because like it is technically there, and that would be the subliminal message on consumerism. Now this is where it really separates people. Like some people like it, like some people like Wall-E because of the simple love story, and some people don't because of the message of consumerism. And I will admit, yeah, it is there, but in its defense, it's not like the movie is not about the subliminal message. That's not what the story focuses on. The story is mostly focusing on the love between Wall-E and Eve. The consumerism message only it's only there to enhance the setting it's in. Like when they're in the by and large blip, and you see all these big like these really like all these people now really really fat, and like just go around in their hoverboards. Like they can only talk on the screen and stuff like that. Like when Wall-E came in, they start experiencing things like that is pretty common nowadays, like actual human interaction, like what we're not doing per se.
Yeah. Although this is as real. And another thing, walking.
I find it interesting that the majority of the people you've talked to have considered the consumerism angle to be a negative aspect. I mean,
I'm not saying that a lot of people have. It's like, I know a few that do.
Oh.
But, like, most, like, a grand majority of people that I know, like, they see Wall-E as a godforsaken animated masterpiece.
Yeah, but because of the love story, not because of the consumerism angle. Like, it's what
yeah.
you're saying. Their measure of, like, the movie depends on how much they see the consumerism angle there at all. Which, I mean, I saw a consumerism angle, and I liked it. You know, because it was different from, like, the really obvious choices, you know? I mean, the humans, they weren't painted as evil. Like, I kind of thought when the movie started out, when we saw this ship thing, that the humans were going to be these evil guys that wouldn't let go of their little dystopic utopia. If that makes sense. But they weren't. In fact, they wanted the chance to make something better of themselves. They just didn't know how. It was just more robots who were the bad guys, which I thought was a really good way of saying it. I mean, I guess I never liked messages of how, like, technology is making us more lazy and less social because we're just talking to people. I hate that. But that was, like, a small part of it, you know? It was more about the not owning up to your responsibilities with what we're doing to the environment and how we're destroying.
I'm not saying it's bad. How Wall-E did it with the message is actually really, really well done, because, like I said, it's not the focus of the film. It's pretty much like it's just there to enhance the setting of the movie. Like, it is a really well executed message. Like, I've seen like a lot of the animated films that I've seen, when they want to try to have a message, they ridiculously hammer it down. Like they try to punch it to you in the face, make it so freaking obvious. And it's even worse when they suddenly do it last minute, when you're watching a movie and then suddenly, whoop, now let's talk about environmentalism. It's like,
preacher.
Yeah, like, we gotta preach this crap while we can.
But those movies that are like in their entirety about environmentalism. Movies and shows.
Yeah. But what I'm trying to say with the consumerism thing, that people like it or not, it's mostly, most of the people that I know, I'm not saying that when people notice the consumerism, they immediately not like it. That's not what I'm saying. It's just that, like, most of the people that I know, they like, when we would talk about Wall-E, that's the main thing that we talk about is the love story, because that's the main aspect of Wall-E. That's the first thing that we notice. Because the consumerism thing is an afterthought, you know?
Well, I think you touched on something really interesting here, Matt, because I went to go see this movie in the theater with the same guy that I went to go see Elysium with, for those of you who listen to the Cinema Lounge bit. And I kind of enjoyed it. He hated it for that whole second part of the film with the human beings, because it was when he saw people, you know, sitting down with all these conveniences, floating around on these chairs and whatnot, he thought that that was paradise. He thought that it was just perfect. You know, this was something that he wanted.
Really?
The kind of thing that he wanted. And I was just
this
like,
this movie was not for him.
But the other theme that it had that kind of bothered me, and not for how it was done in the film, but because of the some of the backlash the film had in particular, it was obviously also an environmental piece. Which,
that mix a bit with the consumerism part, because industry take down forests and most of stuff like that, you know.
But and it only gets really heavy-handed in one scene when we show the backstory of how, you know, humans destroy the world and everything. The point that I'm trying to get at is when this movie was out and people actually went to go see it, that's what they were getting out of it. That's what different movie news outlets were talking about, and, you know, how this is such a big environmental movie. And Andrew Stanton, you guys, who I greatly respect, and you guys know my history with the guy,
mm-hmm.
went on different outlets and talk shows and said, kind of using the same wording that you said, Matt, when talking about the consumerism angle of the film, when people talked about the environmental aspect, he said, no, that's not what this movie is about. This movie is about the love story between between two robots. And while I can see the point there, it's kind of what he seemed to be trying to do was discard the environmental aspect altogether.
Oh, like make it not important. Like he's trying to pretend like it doesn't exist.
He seemed to be trying to pretend like it didn't exist, but everyone watching it, and everyone who also went to go see Cars 2 later, you know, they might as well just say, they do these kinds of messages in movies.
Oh, Cars 2, that's a completely other story. That's another, like, well,
unless,
I guess
why
Cars
don't you just
2,
come out
they didn't...
and admit that, yeah, huh?
Oh, but guys, are the Cars in the Cars movies technically robots?
They never specified.
They're like a sentient automobile.
That's
they never. I think it's just an alternate universe where like cars live, because if they were robots, wouldn't they mess it? Would they explain whatever happens to the humans?
There you go. Someone had to build them.
It's like not a chapter of their lives they look like looking back on.
Yes, as I mentioned last time we tackled Cars 2, even John Lasseter realizes it was a mistake in hindsight. But
we all have to admit our mistakes. Even John Lasseter has to.
But in any case, back to WALL-E, you can say that. My point being, you can say that a movie like Cars 2 isn't about bashing oil companies. It's about It's about...
it's about Mater going down on spy ventures.
Yes. And it would still be incorporating both of those elements. Pull the same trick while talking about Wally and say, no, it's not about environmentalism, it's not about consumerism, it's about a romance between two robots. It's still there.
Yeah. I completely agree with you. Like, what I'm trying to say is that the main aspect is the love story, and it's what everybody remembers the most.
Well, I'm not
like,
arguing.
I'm not saying.
I'm arguing with Stanton's.
Yeah.
Film.
Yeah, because what I'm trying to do is like I'm taking the I'm taking that consumerism message. I'm using it to the advantage. Andrew, try to learn from me. Try to do that next time. Maybe you should have done that with maybe John Carter or something. But just in case, prepare yourself with Finding Dory.
I look forward to Finding Dory.
Same here.
I'm cautiously somewhat optimistic in Finding Dory.
Finding Nemo's overrated.
Okay.
we had that debate.
Shut up, Shark Tale lady.
Anyways, let's go to round two of our films. I know it's actually been a little longer than it should be, but let's do this last round and finish the podcast. So
we got the cohort, we got the new host, we got the new guest, so we got an excuse.
Yeah.
Good. Good.
I'm going back to Esther because I'm so much fun.
Yes, that's true. So let's go for round two here with something from 1986, I believe. James, want to talk about a robot named Johnny Five, and he's alive?
That's 1986.
I said 86.
I heard 96.
I said 80.
You meant to say 86, but you said 96.
Okay, thanks for correcting me.
1986. Okay, following in the theme of what I was talking about before with Astro Boy, that being robots seen as other people or other beings, here is a film that basically just comes out and says it. Number Five is alive. A freak accident. Takes a war machine robot who gets juiced up with electricity, and suddenly he's blessed with a soul because of that. Don't know quite how that works, but is the movie still enjoyable enough following that to
isn't it a Disney movie?
To make it work?
No, it's not a Disney movie.
It kind of wishes it was a Disney movie in some parts.
But, because that would explain everything.
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, this was the era in which you could take a supernatural or sci-fi element and do that sort of thing with it, and not quite be Disney. E.T., for example. But, just have some mystical object be the object of cuteness and whimsy. So this is the story of a robot whose main goal is he's created to destroy, but after being blessed with a soul, his main function is to live, essentially. Thankfully, this movie does not take this whole war aspect of it too seriously, and they were able to make it a very cartoonish and humorous film. At least that's as far as what I was thinking. When I first saw it as a kid, and we used to have this on tape. I don't know what happened to it, but I used to rewatch it a couple of times, and here's the funny thing about it. Rewatching it 25 or so years later, I was sitting down and watching it with my folks, and they said, I can't remember this movie that we had it on tape, but for some reason, I remember that Indian guy.
Oh God.
Oh.
Oh. My God.
Oh.
I forgot about him.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
So
oh shit.
Hey, I teach my dinner.
Between that movie and Peter Pan, I had such terrible misconceptions of Indian culture as a child.
Wouldn't you like to be a pepper too?
For crying out loud.
See, this, well, those are different kinds of Indians, you know, these are...
And then there's the Indian in Short Circuit too.
It's the same Indian.
I don't care if this is a kid's movie, I am still pissed off at you, what the fuck are you thinking?
In Peter Pan, the Indians were more the Native American type.
Native American type, yes.
Yeah.
There's two different Indians. There's Native Americans, and then you got the Indians. Oh, la la la.
Pretty much answering its own question, what makes the red man red?
Yeah, so... And here's the thing. I'm watching it with my folks, and I said, Mom, Dad, you know that's a white guy in makeup, right? That guy's only pretending?
What?
Yep. That is a racist
yeah,
bastard.
He's a realistic Indian, though.
Yeah,
like,
I think
he did a great
I
job.
Think he was a good actor. He put it on pretty much like as good as anyone could.
It's like if you don't know who the actor is, like you could be fooled.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe as a kid. As a kid, I guess I couldn't really tell, but...
As a kid, neither could I. Do I care now about it, now that I know? Actually, no, I don't. Because it's just a character.
It's true, I mean, like...
He's not selling to do it in the party, so why not the actor that did it in Short Circuit?
And everybody loved Apu, even though he's voiced by a white guy.
I think it's a little different to voice though. Like, you're not, like, there's kind of a cultural, historical, negative connotation to putting dark in your face in order to purposely play another culture.
Well, that's mostly associated with blackface, honestly.
Well, the thing is...
It was there for, like, Asian characters, too. Remember Breakfast at Tiffany's?
Mm-hmm.
That happened.
Well, it happens when you can't find a good enough actor to fill that role for whatever reason.
Or it happens when you don't want to, like, Tiffany, I know it was an older movie, but they probably just didn't want
to. Or they want to have Mickey Rooney in the credits.
But
they were drunk and, like, handing out stupid ideas.
Anyways.
I got an idea. Just listen. We're gonna bring in Mickey Rooney and make him a funny, stupid chap. What do you think?
Brilliant!
I love
that
shit. What? Am I right?
Well, here's something interesting. My grandfather used to tell me all kinds of stories about this sort of thing. One thing that he mentioned to me back during the vaudeville days, which he wasn't really a part of, but this was a part of history that was passed down to him and whatnot, was the reason why they started doing blackface routines in vaudeville was because it was white guys trying to bring black comedy that they saw in black stages to white audiences.
Yeah.
So is the blackface or the Indian face, whatever you're talking about, itself offensive, or are the intentions?
There was that popular actor, I forgot his name, but he was known to put on that blackface and go like, "Push me, man, push me."
Al Jolson.
Yes, I think Al Jolson.
Al Jolson. The one thing that I have to say about that is that makeup just not. Just does not age well.
You ain't fooling anyone.
But
you can praise for Uncle Sammy all you want, but we ain't buying it.
Yeah, back in the day, at least, basically there was a reason for it because legally there were some shitty laws in place, but nowadays. You have to think, okay, well, do people know better or not? And I think in the case of Short Circuit, where you have a guy playing an Indian, what I'm watching is and saying, no, it's actually not.
It's yes and
really
no.
I wouldn't really find it offensive because every time that I've spoken with, you know, somebody over the phone and whatnot. Calling a tech center and whatnot where they reroute you to India, that's kind of what it sounds like.
It may sound like a little similar to the Indian kind of accent, but that doesn't mean the way he's written and the way he's portrayed and the way he's casted is not incredibly positive.
Yeah, I mean, like, the reason why I'm saying yes and no, because yes, the act of doing it, that is still kind of pretty bad, but on the other hand, like, the character, he's not going around, oh, Kari, department store, thank you, come again, you know? Like, he's not doing any of that bull crap, he's just acting like a regular character.
He certainly does that in Short Circuit, too, where he's, like, telling robot 41.
Yeah, it's a little more extensive in Short Circuit 2, but not so much in the first film.
All I remember is him swearing like a freaking sailor.
But it's just, yeah, it's...
This character, you guys, he's an infamous part of the movie. Like, he's infamously racist. I feel like it's like talking about whether or not Jar Jar Binks is technically racist. Like, we all...
Against what race? That's an alien.
I think black
people. Well, he is
Well, he is played by a black person, so it's black people offending black people, I guess.
He is racist towards human intelligence.
Oh, boy.
How do
we...
Don't you mean, isn't that intelligentsist or something?
Oh, boy.
Nisa don't know.
So... So, Johnny Five, what makes him unique as a robot?
Well, he's what I find about him as a character is he's for the longest time he was so quotable. I think
mm-hmm.
There were times.
Yep.
There were times when me and my siblings would be going around the house quoting this movie at various points and be like, oh yeah, that was a funny part in the film. I mean, who can forget? Ah, more input. Input, input. And there are some terrific insults that are tossed around, particularly hey, laser lips, your mother was a snowblower. And watching this as a kid, you kind of think about it, and you're not sure why it's funny, but you just like the execution of it. There's something about it that's worthy of a laugh.
Yeah. I don't know if you know this or not, but after Short Circuit 2, Johnny Five appeared again in a short educational film called Hot Cars, Cold Facts. I watched just like a short clip of it. It's in two parts on YouTube. I don't know why. I guess at the time we couldn't upload it fully. But anyways, it sets up how Johnny Five's a citizen now. Like in the movie, he's a citizen, and he gets a house. He gets like a car, and then
does he have kids?
No. So he has a life. He has a house. He has, you know, he's mowing the lawn. He's got a car. And all of a sudden, somebody steals his car. He's like, "Oh my god, my car is stolen!" And it kind of talks about, you know, thefts and cars and how to prevent it and blah. But it's an educational film. It teaches you, like, I was like, "What is this? What?
Is it like? Are they teaching it to like kids or something, or is it to a?
I don't know.
Like,
I
don't know. Like." Why would you bring Johnny Five
to
teach adults about car theft?
It had to be for kids, because why would you want to feature Johnny Five in a freaking educational film about... I don't know. It was the weirdest thing.
Like, next thing you know, they're going to bring in, like, Fievel talking about alcoholism.
Or Fievel talking about the immigration system.
That's a great idea. A crossover of Fievel and Speedy Gonzales.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh,
so,
don't worry, I'll be your coyote. Arriba, arriba!
So, another big thing about this movie is that it's going to be rebooted for a new generation. It's going to be directed by Tim Hill.
The director of Alvin and the Chipmunks.
No.
It's been in this
film.
I think it's the.
Just the Alvin and the Chipmunks movie, or all of them?
Let's see.
I think he
directed the first one and Garfield 2.
Oh, good God!
But see, but this film's.
Oh, please stop.
This film was announced like. A few years ago, and it's still being in development. It's not like anything's coming out next year or 2016. It's just still in development, and nothing's... Because I think I even talked about this on my other podcast a long time ago, and it's still in development. It's like, okay, Short Circuit reboot, sure. Why not?
Why not? Tim Hill, that's why not.
No, actually, there was a... I guess there was a... how he wanted to make it. There was something, because it's completely different than the original. It's, there was something with a little boy in Johnny Five or something. Let me check this out. Hold on. At the time, it was going to be directed by Steve Carr, and he dropped out, and then Tim Hill's going to direct it, but the film's plot would be involving a boy from a broken family befriending the number five robot. So
it would have been like a sequel-ish.
Like a sequel reboot? It won't. I guess it won't feature Stephanie at all. Stephanie.
Mm-hmm.
More input. God, I love Johnny Five. Fucking A.
Disassemble. Dead.
God, it was. Did anybody? Like, feel sad when he squashed that grasshopper? I was like, oh, why'd you do it, man? You're so innocent. Yeah, he killed a grasshopper. Ooh, he's a killer robot.
That's all I'm made to kill. I killed a grasshopper. Now I must kill humanity.
I got a thirst for blood. Let's hop into 1999, I believe, with Brad Bird's The Iron Giant.
So this is a classic, 1999 Brad Bird's film, a precursor to him going on to Pixar to do The Incredibles. This is a very underrated film. The Iron Giant, probably one of the best of the 90s, easily. I'm sure it's not mainstream, but it's popular enough that I think most of you are aware of the story behind the Iron Giant. A young boy by the name of Hogarth Hughes in Maine stumbles upon a sentient 50-foot metal-eating robot and befriends it during the Cold War. It's a very beautifully animated film. It's one of those rare films that can be enjoyed as an adult and as a child. It doesn't dumb it down for its audience. There's no quirky sidekick, unless you want to count the hipster Dean, the beatnik character. There's no real like cutesy character. There's no singing. There's no musicals. It's a very It's very like to the heart of the story. It's a young boy,
which is surprising to find in an animated film of the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, with all the Disney musicals and like even non-Disney musicals. Like I don't know when Quest for Camelot came out, but that kind of already.
I think it was 98.
Hold
on. That's a key researcher.
Yeah, 98.
Warner Brothers did not have a good track record with their animated films that year, that decade. So maybe that's why. I don't know if the Iron Giant bombed, but I know it didn't do all that hot. I think it did bomb.
It did bomb, actually. I think that was like. It kind of like really make them go down. It's the reason why like they kind of stopped making animated feature films for a while.
Yeah, it was
Which
Warner
is a
Brothers.
Shame, because this was a fantastic film. But surprisingly, even though there was no sequel, I'm actually glad this is one of this film does not have a sequel, because there's a lot of elements of the film that aren't answered, like where did this robot come from? Did it come to our planet intentionally, or did it crash land? Was its intent to destroy mankind? Like you never really get an answer for that. So that's kind of that underlying sort of. Isn't it? Like, there's this kind of that level of uncertainty about the movie that makes it ominous, but as well as kind of endearing. If I had to say something negative about the film, like, this is pure nitpicking, but, like, watching it a second time, it kind of feels like there's an anti gun sentiment kind of shoehorned into the film, like three quarters into it.
Mm-hmm.
So, kind of political. I don't know how I feel about it. Like, it's still a good movie, but I don't know. It's very kind of boo NRA kind of towards the end. And, I don't know. I don't know if I should say it. I always thought Dean's character was kind of out of place. I don't know. There's some of his lines, or just his presence there. Like it was kind of, he was almost like an organic plot device to get the movie to go along. I can't really describe it. His character just felt out of place. But these are all nitpicks. It's a solid film. It's It's definitely one of my favorites, and recommend it.
I am Groot.
Oh, I forgot that. Yeah,
Vin Diesel.
It got his precursor to becoming Groot. He got to be. I think it was his first acting role ever. Was the
what?
Iron Man.
No.
I think.
It's one of his.
No, no, he
wasn't. First major roles.
Yeah. He was in, Saving Private Ryan and Strays. But there's one thing I need to mention, and there's one thing I think I kind of have to disagree with you. And what a lot of people say is, I don't think the Iron Giant is underrated anymore. Because now it's up to the point, everybody keeps on saying the Iron Giant is underrated.
It's got a cult following, doesn't it?
Yeah, no, because, I'm starting to see the Iron Giant's following becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, and now it's becoming pretty big, and, at this point, I don't think we could consider it underrated anymore. Now it's pretty much an animated classic. Like, people now know what the Iron Giant is. They now know that it's, it really is one of the best in animation.
Sure.
So, like, at this point, we can stop saying that it's underrated. Because, like, you keep on saying that, but, like, it's not. It's, People are aware of the Iron Giant. I just don't want to call it underrated.
What you consider underrated and what you consider a classic. Like, a classic is one that really, in my
Underrated is The Secret of Nim. Classic is The Lion King.
Nope, we don't have too many people talking about The Secret of Nim.
Yeah, I don't know if I agree with that sentiment. Like, it's kind of like The Nightmare Before Christmas. That was underrated when it came out.
Yeah,
you can argue that now it's not underrated. Because if you go to Hot Topic, it's like 90%, but Nightmare Before Christmas, Jack Skellington gear and socks and just, bags and whatnot. I still think most people aren't familiar with the Iron Giant. People who know it would acknowledge it, but I really don't think it's.
That's the thing. I feel like a lot of people have acknowledged it. Like, I feel like it's in the place that it deserves. Maybe not, like, completely enough, like, because I know that Warner Brothers has yet to release it on Blu-ray and stuff like that. Like, maybe it does need a little bit more of a boost, and it really should. It really is that good. But, like, I don't know. Like, The Iron Giant, I feel like it's much more popular nowadays than, like, a lot of, like, what you can consider is, like, unrated. Like, for sure, right now, it's definitely more popular than, like, a lot of the independent animated features nowadays, and, like, something like The Secret of Kells or, like, Walter with Bashir, you know? So that's the thing, like, like, it's not really crazy popular, but I think it's, like, definitely popular to be considered an anime.
Totally understandable.
Yeah, but you could be a classic and underrated, though, right?
That's what I said. Underrated is Secret of Nim. That's a freaking animated classic. That's a freaking animated classic, and it doesn't have...
To be a classic, you need to either, A, make a really significant mark on, like, the world of the genre.
Yeah.
Which The Lion King did do by setting records for, like, the amount of money that an animated movie makes.
Maybe
and
I should...
A few decades have to go by, and it needs to prove itself to be, like, really timeless.
I guess maybe I worded wrong. Maybe classic wouldn't be the right word to use. Maybe something like big, like, I don't know. Come on, help me out, guys.
I can't say much.
I don't know.
Yes.
I'm gonna say.
You know what I mean, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm gonna say this. I watched this movie when it first came out on tape. I don't know what it was. I can't put my finger on it. I just wasn't into it then, and I'm not sure. I think that Brad Bird did a little bit more of my kind of movie just with his later stuff with Pixar. The Iron Giant I just sort of look at as being a good place to start. You know, saying this is okay, this is something that you've directed, you can direct a movie. It's just that's all that I really feel that it is. But
it's like his start. It's not really something that launched his career like The Incredibles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I will say this. I have to bring this up. Did you guys know it was based on a book?
Yeah, I was just gonna say that. Yeah, it's based on a book. It's Sylvie's second movie is based on something. It's the weirdest thing. Oh, yeah.
It's Ted Huge.
Yeah, it's...
Yes. The Iron...
Michael's saying that Sylvia's movie was based on a thing. I was saying that my next one is too, albeit loosely.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yep.
The Iron Giant is based off of the novel The Iron Man by Ted Hughes, who is also credited as the author for writing the Iron Giant movie. Although I believe I can't put details on everything. I can say that a drastic lot of stuff was changed in between script to screen. Mainly, I think the time period in which it was taking place, the location. Basically, what you have is one thing that does stay true is there's a giant iron being from outer space that lands and on Earth and is befriended by a boy. And it was popular enough as a book that it later went on to be turned into a stage musical by Pete Townshend of The Who.
Oh my God.
Mm-hmm. Who
Holy crap.
In the stage musical as the character of the boy and sang and wrote the songs.
Holy crap. That's pretty cool. Interesting.
And I think Townshend was also a producer on the film The Iron Giant.
That's true. That is true.
Okay. The connection being when The Iron Giant was being made, it came about as being an idea to make this Iron Man book into a musical, into a movie, but then it got drastically changed. Maybe they were planning to make it. Maybe they were planning to originally make it as the musical was. And I realize we've lost Jada. But
that the problem just there.
She's.
I don't know.
Don't worry. You had a little bit of a glitch. Don't worry about it.
Yep.
Yeah, I suddenly couldn't hear you anymore. And then I was just like.
I think your connection went loosey-goosey. We were all still here.
Yeah.
After you left, and now you're back.
Maybe all right. Great first impression, aren't I?
Yes, you are, actually.
Yes,
it's,
you are.
It's quite normal.
Don't worry, you'll be a major hit with the fans.
You'll be normal. It's normal.
So, yeah, essentially, I think what I was trying to say is Iron Giant may have started out as being a straight adaptation of the book, or maybe it was going to be an adaptation of the stage musical, but it ended up getting changed drastically and became the film that we now know.
You know, there's a sequel to that book called The Iron Woman.
Yes. There was actually something the other day that I was perusing around and I found, and I'm glad you mentioned that.
Oh, are you gonna? It's a mad clip of it was a mashup between the Iron Giant and the Iron Lady.
Well, I think I know what you're talking about. It's a poster, right?
Yes.
Yeah, that's actually part of an exhibition. Actually, it's actually really really cool. The theme is make a sequel to a movie that's already made, and there's a lot of interesting ones. There's another one they made, it's like there's a poster that's called Down.
There's
a lot of great ones.
Yeah,
so.
That internet's very creative with that.
It's actually really, really cool, and they seem legit. Like, I wish I could find it again.
I got it.
Copy image URL. Does this work? Yes, it does. Thank you, Google Chrome. There you go.
Hallelujah. Google
the
Chrome.
The Iron Giants.
Oh, right. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
What could have been?
It's funny how Vin Diesel got to be the Iron Giant, because originally Peter Cullen was supposed to be the Iron Giant. How did Vin Diesel... Yeah, that Peter Cullen. How did Vin Diesel knock out Peter Cullen, the most iconic voice actors out there? From Transformers and a bunch of other stuff. I was like, wait a minute, that would have been an awesome movie if Peter Cullen was voicing Iron Giant. Are you kidding me? Man, that would have been awesome. But yeah, Iron Giant is a really, 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 really good movie. One of my childhood films. I used to watch it as a kid all the time. But the next film, I do have it on DVD, and I don't want to pull it out now, but I do have a film that came out in 2004 called I, Robot.
Yes, that's...
Yes.
Also based off of a book. Short story.
Okay. I, Robot. Will Smith is living in this post-robot slave world where he does not like robots. Because of a thing that happened with robots.
That because, well, I think it's a little girl who wanted to be a dentist.
Yeah, that resulted in him
Why
getting
a... Why does that girl want to be a dentist? What kind of stupid does she want to be a dentist?
A brooding attitude? I don't know, as brooding as Will Smith can get. Anyway, he meets this one robot who's, like, different from all the other robots, and that he's... Number five is alive kind of thing going on. And he's accused of being... robot creator, and he has to find out who really did it because he ends up believing that the nice robot is innocent, and it's this whole big conspiracy. And yeah, this movie, I've not read the book, but I'm told that the movie's absolutely zilch like the book in any way, other than the fact that it has the three robot laws in it.
You would be absolutely correct.
Okay.
Because I have not read the book either. But I will tell you that this is not the first time I, Robot was turned into an adaptation.
The movie doesn't strike me as the kind of thing that Isaac Asimov would write, like, in terms of the story and the characters. I don't know, the movie it's not my favorite. I don't love it. It's pretty good, you know, I like Will Smith. I like most of Will Smith's. I like the robot character of Sunny, even though the whole "our robot's really human" thing is a little bit on the nose. You know, I like.
Yeah. Because I feel like it's more of like an action movie for the sake of action movies.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I remember when watching it, it's pretty much this. It's kind of like a conspiracy movie-ish because. All the robots are meant to be, like, personal helpers, like assistants, or slaves, in a way. Wait, what was the movie we mentioned that was, like, it has cyborgs as slaves or something like that?
Astro Boy.
Something in the lines of Astro Boy, but then we got Will Smith being this, being this conspiracy guy, being this, run-down cop. Like that's pretty much it. It's like it's pretty much a bit of a generic action movie with a little mix of sci-fi because you got a lot of the tropes like one of those action movies with the rundown douchey cop and stuff like that, and like there's this conspiracy going on with a little bit of sci-fi with all the robots and like with this artificial intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
In a way, it's like. Yeah, it's like a thing you watch, but don't expect anything good, but don't expect anything too bad either.
Yeah.
That said, Will Smith probably is the saving grace of this entire movie.
Yeah,
like, I feel like I would like the movie at all if Will Smith wasn't. You know?
Yeah, because Will Smith is Will Smith, you know?
I feel like he brings his personality into it. He has a lot of lines of dialogue that I feel like were put in there specifically because of Will Smith. Like, he has the aw, hell, nah. That he does.
Oh, hell no, yeah. But I will admit, there are some quotable moments, like...
His
like
character's
the one...
not that likable.
Well,
I guess I understand his hatred of the robots, because, like, a little girl died. That's pretty...
Like, even, like,
No, but I'm thinking more like the robot is more quotable, like, by just going down. It's like, did you go out?
I did not murder him!
I am sorry if that seemed a little bit false.
I like that scene. That scene was cool. I liked the one bit where Will Smith was questioning the robot's human abilities by being like, could you write a symphony of music? Could you paint an artistic picture? And Sonny was like, can you? And Will Smith was like, A, it's a good point, and B, I like the way Sonny said it. Like, he didn't need it to be a smartass or anything. He was just genuinely like, oh my god, can you do that? That's awesome. Well, I had no idea the criteria was so high.
The aspect of humans as other beings again is heavily present in iRobot, and I think American a lot of American sci-fi or classic sci-fi was sort of a home for that as well, but the film iRobot dumbs that down for an action film premise. What you have in the story, and this is me recalling the time that it was actually adapted for an episode of The Outer Limits, not the classic black and white version of The Outer Limits, the mid 90s version of The Outer Limits, which even 30 years later still sucked. So in the story of iRobot, we have a robot is framed for murder. He does say that he didn't do it, but there is just one problem. In this world, in this futuristic world, robots are not seen as people, and this is one robot who's going to be dismantled because of a malfunction, unless he can prove that he is human. Then he can be tried as a human being. So the entire story of iRobot is him going to court and proving that he is in fact an intelligent being. And his lawyer in the TV show episode is played by Leonard Nimoy.
Oh.
Oh.
Interesting.
But in the end, there's just one problem, as like you do with shows like The Outer Limits and Twilight Zone, and probably in the original source material in which they got this. The good news is, in the end, he has decided by the court as being a legal human being, and therefore he will be tried as a human at a later date. The bad news is, as soon as he walks out of the courthouse, the robot sees a kid who's about to get hit by a car. He runs into the street, saves him, but he's not able to save himself.
Downer.
That's really sad.
Really sad. Wah, wah, wah.
Aw, you.
Well, that was a trial wasted.
That was a downer. That's an out-of-nowhere downer. Like, damn, we're really close to having a happy ending. We might as well just throw a car at it.
It's like you're just watching the episode, and then it finishes. It's like, well, screw you too. I'm gonna go off somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Like Cruel Intentions level of death.
Here's something else that I should probably bring up. Even before that, there was a time in which they were trying to make it into a feature-length film in the 70s. In the late 1970s, Warner Brothers acquired the option to make a film based on the book, but no screenplay was ever accepted. The most notable attempt was one by Harlan Ellison. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that name, but he's a prolific sci-fi author. What do you know? Wrote for the original Outer Limits TV series. Collaborated with Isaac Asimov himself to create a version which captured the spirit of the original. Asimov is quoted as saying that the screenplay would lead to the very first real adult, complex, worthwhile science fiction movie ever made. Ellison's script builds a framework around Asimov's short stories that involves a reporter named Robert Ratanahi tracking down information about Susan Calvin's alleged former lover, Stephen Byerly. Asimov's stories are presented as flashbacks that differ from the originals in their stronger emphasis on Calvin's character. Calvin being, I believe, the robot?
Actually, wasn't Calvin... Wasn't Calvin Will Smith?
Yeah, the Smith character. Okay, well... Ellison places Calvin into stories in which he did not originally appear and fleshes out their characters' roles in ones where she did. So Calvin was a girl in the book.
Friggin' adaptations! Turning chicks into dudes! The chicken robot and the friggin' star of my robot? God!
Hey! It happens the other way around as well. I mean, Hatch Adams. That chick was actually a guy.
They did that because Robin Williams needed a love interest. They did it with an iRobot because they needed a dude to play the lead so the movie would sell.
Although acclaimed by critics, the screenplay is generally considered to have been unfilmable based on the technology and average film budgets of the time. Asimov believed that the film may have been scrapped because of a conflict between Ellison and the producers.
It's because of technology.
When the producers suggested changes in the script instead of being diplomatic as advised by Asimov, Ellison reacted violently and offended the producers. Quote unquote. The script was serialized in Asimov Science Fiction magazine in 1987 and eventually appeared in a book form under the title iRobot, the Illustrated Screenplay in 1994.
I'm like really mad now. I'm sorry, I brought this movie up.
You brought this all upon yourself.
You gotta do your research.
I thought the freaking star was the saving grace and...
And now you're gonna go feminist on this thing.
You were praising Will Smith and then suddenly you were supposed to be a woman.
Like, what? Say what?
There's his next output right there. We'll make a movie called Will Smith with Boobs. See if it sells.
Will Smith with Boobs, no matter what, that's gonna sell.
Okay, so flash forward.
We're just going to be staring at Will Smith's chest in West Philadelphia, born and raised.
Oh my god.
The film, iRobot with Will Smith, actually incorporated plot elements from another Asimov story called Little Lost Robot. Some of Asimov's characters' names and the three laws. But the... The rest of the film was taken from another screenplay called Hardwired by Jeff Ventar, and it's completely unlike the Asimov story, so that explains everything.
All right.
I'm gonna be grumpy for the rest of this podcast, just so what little is left of it.
Hold on, I think I know what to do to solve this.
I can't explain, however, why Will Smith's apartment in the movie looks like a Radio Shack commercial. Guess who sponsored the film?
I got these shoes! They're from 2004, like the movie's release! Oh man, they're actually really comfortable.
Your product placement, yeah. So, with that, I'm gonna tell you a little story, what I've been through with my second film. It's a kind of a long-ish history. So I was trying to go...
Here's something from us. Hope it makes you feel better.
So I,
Happy cow!
You've got the fluffy cow treatment. How do you feel?
It's a fluffy cow. How can you say, how can you stay mad at a fluffy cow?
You, dang you, Matt!
I'm sorry, but we gotta solve this problem. Do you want to keep on going with an angry podcaster?
Yeah, fluffy cows do make some people happy.
Nobody's allowed to have my time if I'm not having my time. I didn't write that rule, just how it happened.
So there's a fluffy cow.
That's a nice fluff. You could pet it. It's so fluffy I can die.
I was going to say that. I was like 2 seconds away from saying that.
Oh, but the man took it away from you.
Aww.
Like you took the Sci-Fi robot.
But it...
That's right, that was
like, it's milk... But just saying, the milk is also... The milk will be also fluffy, so it's like he's milking marshmallows.
I don't know what marshmallows you've been eating. Not any I want to try.
Quebec marshmallows.
To be specific, though, that's actually a fluffy bowl, not a cow.
Yeah, it's a bowl.
So I'm sure you don't want to milk it.
Yeah, I told James that. I was like, when he showed me the first time, I was like, it's not a cow, it's a bull, James.
No udder.
Look underneath. Do you see any udders?
You know, small udders.
Fluffy steer?
But I have seen cartoons, and bulls are the ones with giant horns that have angry eyes.
Exactly.
Not always,
but it's usually cliched. But...
Not what happens.
That's what's being portrayed.
Hashtag not all bulls.
Hashtag let's get on with this. So
I
know.
No.
Okay. Hey, Sharon. This is what you get when you kind of.
Wait, you talked about your second movie already, didn't you?
Nope.
You didn't?
Nope.
It's just me and Mike now.
Okay.
Yeah, there's two left. Just let me. Okay.
Yeah, sorry, Mike, by the way.
You're trying to sidetrack this thing into hell? What, the fluffy cow? God, okay.
It's a state of emergency.
Okay, so I was trying to go with a robot dog theme since we Chomps was a robot dog, and I figured, let's find another robot dog film. So I found a 2004 film called Rottweiler. I watched it. It was utter crap. It was basically a horror film.
Yep,
and crap.
Sorry.
Utter crap.
Get it. In a nutshell, Rottweiler is basically set in 2017, so I guess in 3 years this is going to happen to us, I guess. In the future, if you're a prisoner, you get chased after this robot dog who looks like a Rottweiler, and it's just got this slight... like metal plate on his head, blue like metal eyes sticking out, and it's got metal teeth, and it's just gonna hunt you down, and it's just weird. Like, the film doesn't focus on the dog that too much because it focuses on the prisoner who escaped from prison. It talks about his backstory, how he met his girlfriend who wanted to meet up again, and blah 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 blah. I was like, fuck this movie, I'm gonna find something else. So I go on Netflix and I find this weird Japanese film from 2011.
Oh, no.
This movie is based on a short-lived Japanese show called... God, I'm going to butcher it so bad because it's Japanese. It's Dizan Zobagan. It's basic... The movie is a remake / parody of it. It's called Karate-Robo Zobagan. It's basically...
Gandayar, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Like Gandayar.
Gandayar Zobagan. That's what it was. It's from 1974. Lasted 52 episodes. Only on Region 2 DVDs. Fuck.
No, wait. We're both wrong. Zabogar.
Zobogar. I hate Japanese. I mean, the language is so hard to understand. I never took a second language. Anyways, I just want to experience something different with a foreign film, with a Japanese film. Japanese are really weird, especially in their films, especially this guy. What is the director's name? It was...
Noboru Iguchi.
Yeah, Noboru Iguchi. He's directed films like The Machine Girl, Robo Geisha.
He's also part of ABCs of Death.
Yeah, he did a segment for ABCs of Death. Yeah, he's very...
Oh my god, he did that?
Yeah, he's very prolific with his work. He's very well known in Japanese films. He did
Zombie Ass, The Toilet of Death?
Yep.
Toilet he's of the Dead.
Same director, but this...
I know what it is! Oh my god! No! It is more crazier than you think!
This director has directed some weird Japanese stuff, and it's just... If you watch it, it's just... This is probably one of the tamest out of his films. It's got some weird stuff, but it's not weird compared to his other films. Like I said, Karate-Robo Zubaga is basically like a superhero Power Ranger kind of movie. It's a guy named Damon. He is with the secret police, and he has a motorcycle that transforms into a karate robot, and he fights crime. And he's actually not crime per se. He actually is fighting this evil cyborg clan called Sigma, who killed his father, and he's out for revenge.
I know about this film for two reasons. One, I believe James Rolfe did a Cinemassacre review on it.
Yes.
At one point.
I don't think he did.
He did one on
Mike Matei. Yeah, Mike Matei did Robo Geisha, not this film.
Robo Geisha, but at one point, he did do this film because I specifically remember the Kissing Samurai.
He must have mentioned it.
Warlord.
He must have mentioned it because he didn't do.
Maybe he mentioned it and used a clip in there because I specifically remember that. This movie was. Mike had me watch this the other night because after he first saw it, he was so obsessed with it. And I sat down and watched it with him because
Wait a minute. I know I'm here, and I'm told that this is the kind of thing that I've addressed before, but... Wait, when he says Mike, does he mean you, Mike?
Yeah, me. Yeah, me.
This Mike, right
here. Yeah, me.
He's
yeah,
a
me.
Culprit.
Me.
He was seeking out revenge on me for showing him a movie called Killer Tongue a while back.
yeah, so this is a perfect strange movie to counteract, but I just had to show him the weirdness of the film, and if he's my backup source to say it's true, he's not fibbing, he's not making shit up.
Sitting back and watching this film, okay, so I get that it's supposed to be a comedy. I get that it's based on a kid's show, so they're not looking for any Academy Awards with their special effects either. Everything just looks ridiculous, especially in terms of the effects. But mm-hmm. It also felt like such a fetish movie.
Yeah, there's a couple of instances where you see instant of like, oh, that's a fetish shot, because the guy has a background in adult film, so he kind of, I don't know, I guess he does it with most of his films. He sticks in some of these shots like it's meant to be a fetish video or something.
Well, I do see, like, I get what you mean, because I do see like these 3D girls, and like they have like this attire. It's like hard to keep with a football helmet and like a
exactly. Exactly. They're
Where are all antennas coming out? What is this?
That's what the cyborgs look like. They have the antennas sticking out. That's what the...
No reason, they're dressed up like sexy football
players. Yeah, and I didn't know I didn't know Japanese culture had football. So there's these three robots that dress like football players, and they have this a football bomb they throw at Daemon and Zebogon, and just like it's like what? Where's that coming from?
Maybe they're just taking American culture with no purpose, like how we're taking Japanese culture with no purpose.
It could be. But this film's all kind of weird, because, like I said, there's a lot of robots in this. There's, like you said, it's like a Power Rangers kind of thing where, you know, Daemon would take his microphone and say, Zobagon, change! And he changes into a robot, and he does, like, karate moves, and does karate, and there's like a helipad that comes out of his head and does it for searching stuff, you know, far away. He's got like little toy cars that are split in half that goes together, and they kind of and trying to do that, and it's a cool robot. But there's other robots where their enemy is like, there's a robot called, I kid you not, Diarrhea Robot.
And guess what it looks like?
It looks like
a bunny rabbit.
Looks like it.
It looks like a giant ant.
It's a giant ant called Diarrhea Robot. Of course, you think, like, so it spews acid, so it's like, oh, acid's diarrhea, too. I don't know how they translate that. It's like, can they call it acid robot or ant robot? But Diarrhea Robot just seemed like, it's like, what? And then
there goes the seriousness.
It's
a threat.
At one point during the fight scenes, there is something happens. What was the head on this thing gets jammed, and he starts instead firing acid out of his ass.
Oh,
and
that's...
melts some of the other bad guy robots.
Yep. It was he just gets like headbutted, and all of a sudden gets freaked out, and his butt just starts spraying out acid. It's a weird Japanese film.
Oh, okay. So they didn't have a purpose to call that.
I'm gonna try and get a little bit intellectual with this, regardless.
Oh boy.
Here I go again, robots as people. This movie blurs the lines here.
Yeah. I think I know what you're talking about because I guess the backstory of the robot is that before Daemon's father was killed, he was working on this project for years and years because as a baby, you know, he had a baby brother who died because their mother died after the gate was born, and so their father had to take care of him, and the father had to breastfeed one of the babies, which is his brother, and of course the breast milk didn't agree with him and dies. So apparently he's been working on this big project, didn't care about the son. He's like, I got a black belt, I don't care, get out of here, get out of my life. And so
the father breastfed. Think about that.
So yeah. Father breastfed the baby and died. Tragic. So eventually Daemon comes back to the lab, and you see a projection of the father, like he must have filmed this, like somehow, like expecting to know what he's gonna say. He's like, what is this? This is a robot named Zobagon. It's combined with your brother's DNA. He is your brother in a sense.
Mm-hmm. So you're sort of thinking at this point, well, a little bit of robo DNA, a little bit of human DNA and a robot's not going to really do much. But then the film takes it to another level when we discover the henchmen that the villain uses in the film are half robots. They're people that used to be fully human, but they died and he brought them back.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this isn't too far from anything that we've experienced at this point. Ready for the mind freak?
What, the mind freak is not... didn't happen already?
The mind freak didn't happen already.
No, no, no.
The mind freak is this. The Damon and the female lead henchman have sex halfway through the movie and produce offspring that is half human, half android.
Yeah, so yeah, character's name is Miss... So
it works!
Apparently, yeah, in the film, the character's name is Miss Borg, and Damon, they have sex, robot, cyborg sex, you know, it's weird, because...
Again, every fetish pops up here. There were, like, tentacles popping up, slapping him in the face.
And he's like, this is awesome! This is awesome! It was, like, weird.
So they're going out making little Count Dookus?
So...
Is that what you're trying to tell me?
So there's a
yes.
scene... Yeah, so what happens is apparently this embryo, like, crystal egg, like, pops out when, spoiler alert, she dies, and you see him as this crystallized baby, and then obviously you don't see him again until, and of course this film split into two parts, it split with Damon as a young child, or adult, and then he splits, young man, and he splits it 25 years later. 25 years later, he finds out that they have, they're both their kids. Damon's son and daughter.
And now they've grown up into 25-year-old, young robot humans.
Yeah, I mean, the daughter is half cyborg, half human, and apparently the son is completely human because he takes the father's DNA.
Yeah, see, this is, the film explains it by saying, this is, there is human DNA and robot DNA.
Yeah.
Huh?
it's like, wait, where's it? What robot DNA? Like, what? How does that?
What is it made out of? Rust?
It's really confusing, but.
Do you break down rust and see amino acids?
But it's just, there's a lot of, like, there's supposed to be, like, a lot of plot twists, because, you know, they're like, later on, he's like, you wouldn't want to shoot your father, and there's like, no way, he's not my father. It's like, dude, we've seen the, it's like, oh, you're my twin brother. Well, you don't see the second half, you see the first half, he's like, you're my twin brother. It's like, I knew that from a get-go. I was like, I knew that's going to be the twist. So there was two of them, and he was adopted by the bad guy.
Fighting his evil robot children who become good. Spoiler alert.
Yeah, they eventually, at the end, become good. It's a weird Japanese film, and if you're interested in what the Japanese are into, especially in...
you know, literally into.
Into. I mean, there's a lot of things. There's even...
There's a scene with Miss Borg gets whipped by the bad guy. Mm-hmm. They have her on all fours, and this was the shining moment here. This was where I said, this has got to be some sort of sick fetish movie. She's on all fours, getting whipped from behind, and they've got a cleavage shot.
Did she like it?
No, she didn't like it.
It was agony.
She was screaming, and he makes...
Did it show agony, or is it like,
No, it was high-pitched screaming.
Well, to try and pump things up even more, he starts morphing her face.
Yeah, because apparently when he builds these cyborgs, he can change the face of whatever cyborg he's created, I guess. So he's like, would you like me to change it to the guy who dumped the girl's body from? No, I don't like this face! Change the face. I was like, what?
Yes, he starts giving her a man face.
And it just zip. We didn't know it was like either like a cameo run for like for the crew or directors. I don't know. It was just like a weird segment. It's like, hey, there's the crew of the movie with their face cameo.
Basically, if Mike talks you into it, only watch this movie. But other than that. don't.
I mean, I'm a stinker when it comes to movies. I have a really weird taste in film. I like really, like, so bad it's good kind of films, or it's, like, so fucked up and weird, like, it blows your mind. Like, why did you like this? Why did you think it's weird? It just, I think the weird aspect of films just make me interested in film in general. And that's why the Japanese film was like, okay, Japanese culture, that's fucking interesting. Oh, I would love to talk about that all the time, but these guys...
The perfect one. The perfect one, you guys. You've never heard it.
I think I might know.
I'm not giving it away now. Just know, I have such a movie.
I think I can be ready with it.
You're not ready, but I have.
Ooh. Ooh. Well, maybe we'll never find out. But, yeah. God, yes. Just, let's just change it to the most recent film that came out this month.
Mm-hmm. Many.
Oh. Anyways, I'm gonna go. So what I'm gonna talk about, I was thinking of ideas for the second movie to talk about, and it was on the day that I saw it, I decided, why not talk about this? It's perfect. I am referring to, of course, the recent Disney animated feature, Big Hero 6.
Mm-hmm.
Any of you guys seen it? Some of you not seen it?
I have. No.
Are there going to be spoilers? Because I do want
to. I'll try not to spoil. So the thing with Big Hero 6 is essentially this is what really kicks off the merger of Disney and Marvel, because this is definitely a mix of both.
The murder or the merger?
Merger.
Okay.
This is the mix of the two, and. Like, it really shows, and they really took both of their aspects and really make something that's amazing. I wouldn't say amazing, but something that's really, really good. On Marvel's side, you got all the action, and you got the technological aspect, because this is mostly about, like, the superhero action. And also, like, you learn a lot about the technology that goes into it. Like, they talk about all the scientific aspects, the chemistry, and all that stuff. And, like, how each character's powers, like, they go individually with who they are. Like, we got the chemist, we got the guy who likes the lasers, you got electromagnetics, the main character, Hiro, he likes robotics. And then you got, the comic book fan that loves Kaiju. And funny enough, he's actually the most interesting character. Fred, I'm referring to. And so you got that aspect of Marvel. And then you got Disney's side, where you pretty much got all the creativity, and you got the nice animation, and you got the really well-told story. Because one of the most surprising things about Big Hero 6 is that this actually goes into dealing with the death of a loved one. I'm not going to say who for you, Sylvie, but, in any animated films, like, you would always see, like, their mother died and stuff like that, but they never really go down into it. They would just, like, mention it. It was like, oh, yeah, mom's dead. Oh, yeah, let's just move on with what we're doing. And the thing with this is that but in here, like, they really go down into the psychological aspect and, like, how Hiro has to really deal with it, you know? Like how does he feel about dealing with this death and stuff like that? And then you have, the robotics aspect. And there are pretty much two robots that are there. Number one is pretty much these little magnetic things in which... like, he created, like, millions of them,
And Hiro would just, like, he would wear this special headband, and it would allow him to do whatever he wants. Like, to do whatever he wants, like, make it build whatever it wants and all that stuff. And then, you got the most popular aspect of the movie, Baymax, which is actually...
Oh, yes. Hairy baby.
Hairy baby. Is actually... He's actually made to be this mechanical nurse. Like, he's made to, like, pretty much go and heal people. Like diagnose them and suggest them what to do to heal and all that stuff. And, like, he's all inflatable. So, like, he's made to be, like, a huggable thing. And so that's pretty much the whole thing. You got the complex story writing and a great story told from Disney's side, and then you got the action side, which it's a little bit reminiscent to Iron Man, in a sense, from Marvel. Creating something that's actually... Someone clapping at the fridge.
That's on my end, sorry.
Okay, no, but anyways, and you make something great. I have never really read anything from the comic. I've never even heard about the comic before Disney came in with this. But I've apparently heard that the comic really isn't much. Like, no one really cares about the comic, but I think, like, Big Hero 6,
somebody
it's
should
not going
to
change anything to the comic, but it's definitely going to shed some new light about the movie.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what I have to say about it.
Yeah, the only difference is I've read about between the comic and the film is that with the female characters, they typically draw them a little bit more, you know, sexy. But that's
one more
Marvel.
That's like
Marvel
I know,
for you.
Like
somebody called
Lemon,
the list,
but, like
somebody
they try to make her. Yeah, like I know in the comics, Honey Lemon was supposed to be much more sexier. Like, and also like another change I noticed is that they made Wasabi black. Like, Wasabi was supposed to be Asian, but now, like...
Everybody was supposed to be Asian. It's in the comics, every character is Asian.
That's why their last names are Yamamoto or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, no, like, we know Hiro is... Hiro is definitely Asian, but, like... We got Wasabi that's black. Honey Lemon, well, she's white. Then Fred is white. Then Wasabi is black, so, like... We got that multicultural thing going on.
Yeah.
Well, it does live in a... It does exist in a city called San Francisco.
San Francisco, yeah.
Yeah, it's really interesting, actually, the combination.
Yeah, another interesting thing is that it really does mix a lot of the American and Japanese culture, both in terms of the animation and, like, the setting and all that stuff,
mm-hmm.
because, like, on the surface, it's all Japanese. Like, you got all the Japanese things going on, and even the characters have this anime-based design, but the culture, how it functions, and, like, and from the anime, like, how the animation was made, that's where you see the American side of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely Disney really did mix this very well. It works,
yeah.
I gotta say.
I've seen the film myself, and as far as the plot is concerned, you can play the Disney cliche drinking game, but
that is
and
true.
I could go down the list, but then I'd give away the whole film.
Yeah.
You know, but you've got the whole parents dead thing, and so after that you've got. Does it have anything enjoyable? Oh, you bet.
Yeah.
Oh, you bet.
Yeah.
It does have a heart to it that makes you feel for the characters. They're likable enough that you want to see more of it. And just to be to completely remain spoiler free, I'll just say this: part of the film is kind of like Karate-Robo Zaborgar done right. And if you only, if it, I'm not going to explain that for you guys. Just go see the movie, and you'll see what I mean there. in terms of the Baymax character, they did specifically redesign that character from the comics to be more huggable. In the comics, they give him many different designs. Some of them are more.
Yeah, he kind of looked a bit like the Thing from Fantastic Four or something like that. It's like he's made like this big, you know, like this the giant character, you know.
He's made to kick ass. Sometimes
yeah,
he's
something
a bit
like
a lizard, or something like that. When they reworked the character for the film, what inspired them actually was these Japanese nurse robotics that they heard about, and they actually do have these types of robots where they've got robotic bones and inflatable limbs, but it's not anywhere near what the movie had to offer. They just sort of looked at this and said, "This is cute. Let's roll with it and see what we can do." And they made a big huggable creature.
Yeah.
And
they explain his design very well. Like that's the best part. But also, I will mention that one setback of this film. Like that kind of keeps it away from being like really amazing is that it can be a little bit predictable. Like there are some part like because this is kind of the inventor and creation type of story, and they do like notch down the like the tropes that come with it. And like I will admit, like there is a villain in this movie. For me, it's actually very obvious who it is.
Same here. It was so.
And I consider it a fault. Like for me, I consider it a fault because usually I don't predict these things. Like I mentioned this in my review that, like I didn't know that King Candy was actually Turbo or that Hans was a villain.
I saw King Candy coming, like a mile away.
But I didn't. A lot of my friends did, but I didn't. So if I'm able to predict who a villain could be, then that's a problem.
Disney's doing a lot of that, isn't they?
Disney's doing that a lot nowadays, actually.
The past three animated movies, the bad guy has been a twist.
Yeah, that's kind of weird, actually. Like, I don't know why. Like, they feel like they have this thing going.
Huh. Like a trend.
You know.
I'd like to see another, like, over-the-top villain who, you know, from the start. Like, you know, another Mother Gothel, another Dr. Facilier.
Oh, yeah. Maybe they'll have that for something like Moana, maybe.
Maybe.
We'll see.
So I have a theory now. After having seen this film, this is the merger you say between
Disney and Marvel.
Disney and Marvel. We know that the Marvel films have their cinematic universe in which all the characters interlope with each other.
Mm-hmm.
So here comes along this film, which is technically a Marvel movie.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fully animated.
I don't think it's part of the Marvel cinematic universe.
It's not a part.
It's not? There's... When you see this movie, there's going to be stuff in there that you know.
I'm sure there's some throwaway stuff, but...
Like, they would have mentioned it. That's the thing, like... Because they recently... Disney recently did this big announcement for, like, Phase 3 of Marvel,
mm-hmm.
and none of which they ever mention Big Hero 6. That and also, like, if you check out Disney Infinity, they also included Hiro and Baymax, but they consider it a part with the Disney side of it. They consider it like with the Disney originals with Merida and Stitch and Donald, but not with the Marvel characters like Thor, Hulk, Iron Man, and Captain America.
If they can cross over, if Disney can cross over Frozen with Once Upon a Time, they're gonna find a way to do this.
I'm not saying
I think so.
I'm not saying you're wrong, but, like, they're not real, like, we're not gonna see, like, in Avengers 3 suddenly, like, Baymax to come out. Just...
You don't.
There's not gonna be a big battle scene with the Hulk and Iron Man, and then you're just gonna see Baymax walking with his soccer ball.
Like, with Once Upon a Time, it's not meant to be in the same universe as the Disney movies.
That is... Well...
It's meant to, like, be a different take on said story.
True, but when they copied over Frozen, they pretty much copied that over at verbatim.
Well, yeah, it's pretty close to, with little changes here and there, but they had to do that because Frozen was recent and contractors to believe.
Actually, funny enough, like, the people of Once Upon a Time, they took a gamble. They actually got Frozen, they actually got Frozen long before the movie was released, actually.
Interesting.
Yeah, they didn't know it was a success when they end up getting it, so. Like, it seems like such a marketing thing to really popularize on Frozen, but in actuality, like, it was...
Well, it was a marketing thing. It was just a risky marketing thing.
Yeah, it was a risky marketing thing.
I would have gone for the Princess and the Frog, still.
It's true. Like, they would have stayed safe if they kept, like, Rapunzel, or they brought in Tiana with Prince Naveen, but...
They did bring in Rapunzel for, like, one episode.
Mm. But is it Mandy Moore Rapunzel?
No, it was actually a very different thing that they did.
Exactly, that's the thing. Or you know what I can imagine that they could do in the future? I could so imagine this. Once Upon a Time with Into the Woods.
With the, same idea. Because Into the Woods already has, like...
Not with all their characters.
All of the characters in Into the Woods, I think. Not except Jack. No, Jack and Evie Yeah,
so why don't they start taking all these fairy tale characters now and importing them into the Marvel movies with the
oh, jeez.
Fairy tale Marvel universe.
Oh god, yes. Fairy tale cinematic universe.
Everybody told Disney not to do it when they learned that Disney was buying Marvel. They were like, whatever you do, don't make like Disney's Princess Superhero crossovers because that runs. And Disney was like, alright.
But isn't Elsa kind of like the poor man's Emma Frost anyway, or just like an X-Men since they don't have the rights to X-Men?
That's true. I'm still waiting. I'm still vouching for that Tinkerbell and Baymax matchup. I'm just waiting for that movie to happen. Or Tinkerbell with Rocket Raccoon. Whatever you want.
No, it's gonna be. No, it'll be most likely Tinkerbell with Groot.
Okay.
Or worse, original 1953 Tinkerbell with Groot. You know the one I'm talking about, the bitchy one.
Oh, yes.
I like Tinkerbell.
I've honestly never really seen Tinkerbell, but it's so funny trying to compare, like, the original two. Oh my god.
The sweet, cute little...
You got the sweet little fairy, and then you get the one from the cartoon, total bitch, trying to beat up Wendy.
Well, honestly, that's what the classic Tinkerbell is like. They just made her all sweet because she became, like, a Disney icon, and
yeah.
You can realize, now she's as likable as Mickey or Jiminy Cricket, is she? She should just change that.
Yeah.
Make her bland. That's the Mickey Mouse way.
Make her just use her wand, do the intro. Anyway, I just bring out Tinkerbell. Oh, boom, there you go.
At least Jiminy Cricket talks.
You know, the irony with Jiminy Cricket is that he is so bland and forgettable in the movie, yet they made him so... They changed him to be so much better.
In Pinocchio.
Like, in Pinocchio.
He's a cute little cricket.
Yeah, but he's like
pretty funny. I've got no strings on me. I totally forgot about Ultron in the new Avengers film. He's a robot.
That's another sign where Disney and Marvel are merging together. You got Disney villains? No, you got Marvel villains singing non-villain Disney songs.
There are no streets on me.
Next thing you know, you're gonna get... And then you're gonna get Venom singing Under the Sea.
Yeah, the trailer music was a cover of a... Yeah, some darker Disney tunes and trailers.
It works just about as well as it sounds in the trailer.
It just,
you know, funny
it...
enough, I actually had a poll asking people, like, which one do you prefer?
It's this one.
I Got No Strings.
I Got No Strings is creepier, way creepier
Lana
than...
Or Lana Del Rey's Once Upon a Dream, and a lot of people, the majority is pretty much I Got No Strings.
Well, oh, yeah.
I've heard the full version of Once Upon a Dream, and I thought it was... And plus, they're doing two different things. Like, Once Upon a Dream, specifically a dark version of Sleeping Beauty.
With
Age of Ultron, they're just kind of, like, taking the strings and puppets.
Yeah, it was...
Well, I mean, like, it's like at least if I Got No Strings, it sounds badass. Once Upon a Dream, it sounds like a killer is singing that.
Yeah, that's the idea. A killer Sleeping Beauty, or rather, a killer singer of a song. Cool.
You make it sound like a good thing. That actually.
It's not.
Gee, that wasn't my ultimate.
It's scary.
Yes.
Freaking scary. I don't like scary. I get scared easily, okay?
You're not the only one. You're not the only one, Matt. You're not the only one. I get scared very easily. I totally forgot to mention, because as Matt was talking about Big Hero 6, you three were chatting below about what Sylvie sent in the chat, and one of them said female robot tits, and I was like, I totally forgot about Karate-Robo Zabak, the tits, because Ms. Borg's tits are literally missile launchers. So she goes and goes,
launching jubblies?
Yep, so she has, like, this, like, metal cover, and then all of a sudden you go, doot, doot, and missiles just come right out of her boobs.
Oh my god.
So if you
checking out the thing that Sylvie sent, it's like really nice piano.
It's like it's like
what the?
You make Austin Powers look subtle.
His reaction is priceless.
Japan.
Oh yeah, I love these reactions so bad.
Why is that? Why is that nose running away from that girl nose with a knife? What the?
This might be the first time I've ever seen tits not improve something.
Yes, you.
Oh my god. This has been the... We'll end with that, because that's priceless. So yes, this has been the long... I kid you not, this has been long for us. It's a long discussion about robots.
I hope it's not always this long, because...
No.
I kid you not, I'm sorry. We just carried away, and robots got major influence. Hopefully next time... I know, I just tried it. Next time, 2 weeks from now, I'm not going to let you guys guess it, because it's going to be a really complex topic. It's going to be our first ever Cinema Royale topic. Since the show is called Cinema Royale, we got to have two feuding topics. It's Sci-Fi Month, so we're going to have the big discussion of which is better, Star Wars versus Star Trek. This is the biggest...
Should we not reveal what side we're on yet? What if it turns out to be totally imbalanced, like we're all on the same side?
Think about it, rewatch the films, we just collectively, for 2 weeks, think about it, like,
well,
which... Because this is the biggest geeky debate ever in sci-fi, and I want to see what you guys think about which is the better sci-fi franchise, Star Trek or Star Wars. With that, just think about that for 2 weeks. So, with that Cinema Royale, oh, goddamn, long episode. See you in 2 weeks. in the comments below, are you Team Star Trek or Team Star Wars? I'm Mike Mixtape. I'm gonna pass out.
See you later, dudes. And with that, we all shut off.
Ciao for now.
Hmm.